Take your seats, please. Let's open the March 6, 2018 City Council meeting. Let's do the Pledge of Allegiance. Please call the roll, Madam Clerk.
Councilmember Friedman?
Here.
Councilmember Dominguez?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Rouse?
Here.
Councilmember Hart?
Here.
Councilmember Sneddon?
Here.
And Mayor Maria?
Here. We have service award pins. Mr. Casey?
Yes, good afternoon, Madam Mayor and council members. As you know, each month I like to come to council and recognize city employees for achieving certain milestones of employment with the city. I'd like to read some names into the record. There are no one here to receive their pins in person today. With 5 years of service to the city, Juan Carlos Diaz, a painter with the Public Works Department, and Andre Romero, parking enforcement officer with the Police Department. With 10 years of service, Jessica Grant, project planner, Community Development Department. With 20 years of service to the city, Eric Beecher, police sergeant with the Police Department. Frank Dealey, reservoir and dam care distribution operator, Public Works Department. Dale Escobar, wastewater collection system project coordinator, Public Works Department. Miloslav Pavlovic, senior control systems operations specialist, Public Works Department. And Scott Vincent, assistant city attorney for with the city attorney's office. And with 30 years of service to the city, Eric Johnson, water distribution operator, emergency services with the Public Works Department.
Congratulations to all of them. Mr. Casey, do we have any changes to the agenda?
No, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. This is the public comment period. Veronica Aguirre Dutton, you're first. And you'll be followed by Margie Bushman. You have 2 minutes.
Okay.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Veronica. I present to you my petition on change.org to ban plastic straws in Santa Barbara County. To date, we have 1,015 signatures that support the ban. Removing the single-use plastic straw in SBC would be a huge victory, and we would be joining the most recent cities to ban plastic straws, San Luis Obispo, Santa Cruz, and Malibu. They are dangerous to sea creatures. They are polluting our environment and destroying our coastline as they continue to pile up and litter our streets. 5 million plastic straws are thrown away every day. They do not biodegrade, and they cannot be recycled. The alternative to plastic straw are paper or reusable straws. Restaurants everywhere are seeing a decrease in cost switching to paper and are reporting that the transition was a success. We are a beloved, beautiful city that should be a leader for smart and eco-conscious choices that support our environment. I strongly believe we have to be the next city that will demonstrate the need to make these little changes that will have a huge impact on our planet's health. Please read my petition for more information on the terrible trouble that plastic straws create and how prohibiting them in our county and our county will be a simple shift. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Margie Bushman, come on up. You'll be followed by Wesley Rowe. Oh, Wesley's taking your time. Very good. You have 4 minutes then. Welcome.
I'm the shy one, so I get to talk. It's really true. This is really great. First time with the city council, and so appreciate the council and all the work they do. It's quite complicated, and it's amazing all the time and effort you guys put in. It's really appreciated. I'm here to talk about a film that we're bringing to Santa Barbara on March 8th, 7 p.m. at the Marjorie Luke Theater. It's called The Evolution of Organics, and it's the story of the organics movement in California starting from the 60s, and it's a very joyous film. It, like, tracks those young people. They're full of life. Right to, we'll see them 50 years later. They're still at it, the movers and shakers. And the thing that they did, they brought a cultural revolution that changed the way we eat food, and so many of the people in our community were part of that. You know, we have a great history right from the CEC, community gardens. We have Santa Barbara Food Action Plan. We have created all these things starting from the 60s forward. And this has been a kind of a process over the time. Farmers markets, That was came out of that energy. All these things that create great wealth for our city. It's an economic thing, food. And people usually don't focus on it. But we're a city of restaurants and really appreciate the, you know, people go buy from local farmers. And it's been a movement that has changed and supported the farmers because they started out, and you'll see from the film, it is a laugh that they really didn't know what was going to unfold. And then what we have is a great change in our society as a result. And so all the farmers, anybody that buys local food, restaurants, everybody's coming, you know, is coming for free. And if you can't afford it, you can still come. We appreciate people that buy tickets, but it's open as a community celebration, a joyous one of our food revolution, which has happened here. So anyway, thank you for your time.
That was March 8th. What time and where again?
7 p.m. Uh-huh. at the Marjorie Luke Theater. And okay. You're welcome to come. It'll be a lot of people who started the movement will be there. The ones that actually, I managed to round up the people that started the farmers market. They'll be there. So there's a special group that's coming. They did a lot to, and I know when they did it, they were considered outsiders. And they went from outsiders to insiders and changed our community.
Thank you, Mr. Rowe. Phil Walker, you're next. You'll be followed by Pete Del Bello.
Didn't even know I was next. Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and members of the City mm-hmm. Council. There were a couple of city workers mentioned for their service award time. I had the pleasure to work with both of them, Dale Escobar and Milosav Pavlovich. It's a tongue twister, Pavlovich. And, you know, they made my job easier, and hopefully I made their job easier, too. I'm now retired, but if I can make it through out what I went through for 35 years, it's an accomplishment that everybody was involved in. One other quick thing. I've dealt with it for years. You know, in the older parts of town, the property owner's property line, the front line, ends at the sidewalk. In most cases, I won't say every, but then you have the sidewalk and then the parking median or parkway, and with the street sweeping added on and now the AUDs or ADUs, accessory development units, within so many feet of public transit, you do not have to provide parking, and the thing that puts a real crimp into it now is what's happening to the parkways or parking medians. Some of them are so barrier set that you can't even get out the passenger side door anymore. So I'm thinking through the whole thing, and I'll get back on that one. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Del Bello, come on up. Michael Miranda is giving you his 2 minutes, and so is Mr. Gallegos. You have 6 minutes then.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Mayor. Okay. Madam Mayor and City Council, my name is Pete Del Bello and I'm a Santa Barbara native. You ought to forgive my appearance today. I was at the clinic with plantar fasciitis, so, and actually I'm heading back, but they said, don't go to City Hall, you're just going to have more pain there. I said, well, don't they already know that? But I have a high tolerance for misery. That's why I come here every week. But I just want to, a few things are important, even though I want to see everybody too, because you're all so nice to me, of course. I know this is on the agenda, so I'm just going to mention real quickly, without mentioning the number, that I support the request from council members Dominguez and Sneddon. And if you read on the agenda, you'll know what number that is. And
you know better. You're supposed to talk about that when that item comes
okay.
up. We're okay. Okay. Let it go for today.
Okay, because I got to go, because I know you're going to miss me, but I got to go after I finish. Okay. The Coda Street bike path, I'm very concerned about that. I know it's only been there 2 weeks in official status. And, you know, it's my understanding that it was a $30,000 investment. That's my understanding. Correct me if I'm wrong. And, you know, and it's, you know, it's made an inconvenience for 39 motorists because of the removal of parking. And, you know, I go there, as you know, I know I'm on Milpas every day, and I go on Coda Street. It's one of my top 10 streets that I go to. And I've talked to some people in the neighborhood, and I said, I think I've only seen one or two cyclists in 2 weeks. And the few people I talked to who live in the neighborhood said, that's about right. That's what they see. And they're there all the more than I am. So, and then on top of that, the curb is dirty. You know, I don't know. I guess I don't know if a feasibility study was done. I don't know. You know, and I don't know. I know there's maybe some of the great intellectual wizards in this city could tell me how they're going to keep the curbs clean when the street sweepers can't get to the curb because it's blocked off because of the bike lane. To me, that's, I don't know, it doesn't make sense to me. Doesn't make sense. But so I'm here to talk about that and an event that's coming Sunday. You have to forgive me. I'm not as organized as usual. And also forgive my appearance. I feel like I'm not even in the top 10, you know. But next week, and the state of the city, I'll be there Thursday, and I'll try and, you know, I'm trying to keep up with Councilman Hart, you know. He's a good GQ role model. I'll get there one day. Once I get in your tax bracket, sir, I'll definitely be there. And but getting to Sunday, my friend, as I mentioned her in January, Josie Franceschini Gower, who was a victim of the Montecito mudslide, will be remembered on Sunday. Josie was an amazing woman who had thousands of friends. A bistro-style characterization painting by Bill Dalziel of Josie Gower will be hung at 5 p.m. at the Wine Bistro at 516 San Ysidro Road in Montecito. Kate Carter from Life Chronicles will be there to capture your stories about Josie. All friends are encouraged to bring a photo, something from Josie, and to share their story with Katie. You know, I have many memories of Josie, and if she was still here today in person, I would ask her, because one of the reasons we got along so well is we lived each day as if it was our last. And the reason I do it is naturally because of my health. And I wish I could ask her why she lived each day as if it was her last. And in a way, it's a good thing she always did, because we see tragedy can strike at any time and anywhere. And so I wanted to come here, and that was the main reason, to talk about Coda Street and of course, mostly about Josie. And it was a wonderful woman, and I miss her dearly. She was a good friend. And as mentioned, I'll keep it within the, I know I got 45 seconds left, that live each day as if it's your last. We're all here for a reason. We're all here to do important things. And tell the people that you care about and love that you love them. And as mentioned, I will see all of you at the State of the City on Thursday, and I will be dressed much better, and hopefully I will be in less pain as well. Thank you for your time and kind attention. Take care.
Thank you, Mr. Del Bello. Mm-hmm. Anna Marie Gott is next, Francesca Galt, and the final speaker will be John Douglas. And while she's coming up, the State of the City is Thursday, 7 in the morning for the breakfast reception, 8 o'clock at the Lobero for the presentation. Ms. Scott, go ahead.
Good afternoon. Puppet Palooza has not ended. Santa Barbara residents thought that this would only be a 4-day event. We now find out that Puppet Palooza could turn into a multi-year event that will have weekly showings here every Tuesday at 2 p.m. from these council chambers, thanks to Kathy Murillo. You see, last Thursday, Murillo hot-footed it to Buellton. where the Democratic Party of Santa Barbara County was set to endorse someone for the 3rd District. As everyone is now aware, Oscar Gutierrez was endorsed, but only after Murillo lobbied those who were casting votes to vote for him. Did Murillo endorse Oscar Gutierrez because he was most likely to become Murillo's next puppet? As a political newcomer with no experience, it's hard to see how he could be not anything but indebted to Murillo and all too willing to become Murillo's next puppet on the city council. Cronyism and partisan politics, as usual, is alive and well in Santa Barbara. Thank you, Murillo, for reminding us of this. Thank you.
Francesca Galt, come on up. Welcome.
Welcome. Good afternoon, Mayor and City Council. Can you hear me? The Mission Canyon Bridge is a registered historic landmark. It's the oldest known masonry arch bridge in Southern California. It was designed and paid for by Santa Barbara's early pioneers and created by master stonemasons with local sandstone before the use of power tools. So well built that it didn't even crack during the massive Santa Barbara earthquake of 1925. There's a place near the bridge at the Rocky Nook Park entrance where the Chumash collected wild cherries. It's a safe bridge and a safe road, and the public doesn't want it touched. Historic roads and bridges need not be required to adhere to current safety requirements. Please protect this unique cultural landscape. Thank you.
Thank you. John Douglas? And you'll be the final speaker.
Thank you, Mayor Murillo, and the City Council for allowing me to speak. I attended a meeting, statewide meeting of the Healthcare for All California, which is a organization, a grassroots organization, working hard for many years to bring single payer health care, universal health care, to California. And they had their statewide board meeting, and it was really informative. I've been working on this issue on and off a little bit since 1994 when there was a statewide initiative. I think it was Prop 106. I don't remember the exact number. In any case, the state is still working on it. It's not a radical proposal. The state legislature has sent bills to the governor's desk twice in the past decades. Unfortunately, Governor Schwarzenegger vetoed both bills that would have created a single payer system in this state. The current bill before the legislature is SB 562. Proposed by, I think, Representative Lara and Atkins, and it died in the assembly last year. It was tabled, but it's still alive. People are pushing hard for it, and I'm here to ask the City Council to consider if you haven't already, declaring a resolution or creating a resolution supporting SB 562. The following cities have already done so. They did so last year: Los Angeles, San Francisco, Berkeley, Santa Cruz, Alameda, Richmond, Oakland, Eureka, Arcata, El Cerrito, and Albany.
Your time is up, sir.
And I just wanted to say, I wanted to thank Kathy Murillo for your leadership in giving the opening remarks at the meeting last Saturday.
You're welcome.
So thank you, Kathy.
Thanks. All right, we move on to the consent calendar. Items to read, Madam Clerk.
Okay.
Item 3, introduction of an ordinance for a supplemental lease agreement with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. The recommendation is the council introduce and subsequently adopt by reading of title only an ordinance of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara approving and authorizing the waterfront director to execute a supplemental lease agreement extending the lease term an additional 3 years with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration located at 113 Harbor Way commencing on June 1st, 2018.
That's it? Okay. Anyone pulling an item from the consent calendar? No? I'll entertain a motion then, please.
I'll move the consent calendar.
A motion by Hart, second by Rouse. If there's no further objection, we'll waive further reading. And all in favor? Aye. Okay. That passes unanimously. Thanks. Next item, we had an ordinance committee meeting today. Madam Chair of the Ordinance Committee, Councilmember Sneddon.
Yes, I would like to report out. We've had two very public comment-filled meetings. I applaud the Planning Commission for all their hard work and staff. And out of Ordinance Committee, we are the next step will be bringing the ordinance, the draft ordinance for ADUs, to City Council with following recommendations from the Ordinance Committee regarding fire, covenant, open space, and junior ADUs, which will come before you once they're drafted.
And that's the accessory dwelling units?
Yes.
Okay. And a report from our Finance Committee, Mr. Hart.
The Finance Committee met today to hear a recommendation from staff regarding extending the professional services agreement for audit services by 2 years. And the Finance Committee recommended a 1 year extension, and that will also be coming back to the Council for approval at a later date.
All right. Next item, Madam Clerk.
Item 9, resolution in support of widening and installing State Street sidewalks and buffered bike lanes under Highway 101. I'll read the recommendation as well. The recommendation is that Council adopt by reading of title only a resolution of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara to include widening of the State Street sidewalks and the installation of buffered bike lanes under Highway 101 into the City's Capital Improvement Program and direct staff to work with Caltrans for project approval and to apply for funding grants.
Are you ready, Mr. Dayton?
I am.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council members. There are very few projects that Public Works does that get to be these very milestone transformative projects in the life of the city that are highly visible. And the item today is such a project that we're bringing to you. The State Street Undercrossing, most of you are familiar with the Undercrossing, and many of you know the history of Santa Barbara and State Street and how it's changed over time. The main thing, without going deep into the history, the plaza, the State Street Plaza that was used to have parking on both sides and five lanes of traffic and was removed to create what essentially is an outdoor shopping mall. And you can see that in the distance beyond the State Street Undercrossing, which is the one Highway 101 going through town. For many years, it was just the north side of the street in downtown that was improved. And after the Undercrossing was built, the lower section of State Street below the freeway and our waterfront was equally, it was actually as wide as it was four lanes in that section. But now with the Californian being completed and the new plaza-like state streetscape being constructed, and now you can see the plantings. This is looking up from Cabrillo. You can see the plantings that are done, and everything's starting to germinate. The trees not mature yet, but you can see in the background how this side of the street or side of the freeway will be like the other one. This wonderful walking place for walking. But then when you get to the Undercrossing, it's a different story. It's almost like we didn't know the future and how it was these two streets would look and have a pedestrian feel. And we have gotten many, many comments, more and more now that the lower side of the waterfront portion of State Street is now finished. We get more and more comments and feedback about how State Street has become somewhat of a barrier. You can see the difference in the amount of pedestrian space allocated versus bicycle versus vehicle. The narrowness of the sidewalks, if you're walking abreast and you come to another walker, then you're walking single file on State Street. And then you have the barriers there that are the pylons that are on the side of the sidewalk that are take up a foot and a half of the room on that space. And then the experience underneath the street also being somewhat of a problem in terms of the experience. The State Street undercrossing is a very significant place for transportation, for vehicles, for pedestrians, for bicycles. Getting across Highway 101, and you can see the map to the side there where we have, it's one of four places in the city where you can cross 101 without on-ramps or access to freeways. So there's no conflicting traffic that's crossing the pedestrian way. And so this is also because of the development of the waterfront and downtown, a lot of people coming from various places funneling to this one location. So really, really important place to cross. More recently, Nina Johnson has led an effort to a community effort about what that place could be like if it had a little bit more of attention to it. Could it actually be a place that people would go to? And she has provided leadership, and we had a community workshop that was very well attended in November of last year, where people came together in a very creative way to see what could we do, answering the question, what could we do in that space? And we received many, many comments about the space, the sidewalks need to be wider, it's just too little of a space. Do we really need all those space for lanes now that we have narrowed State Street above and below the freeway? And so coming out of that meeting was this idea that not only are we going to shape and create art and community art there, but is there a public works project that can go and be the canvas, if you will, for that art? In a master plan way, in terms of what the city's master plans are saying about State Street, specifically the bicycle master plan referencing it as a place that needs safety improvements, a collision record exists. And then from the pedestrian master plan talks about that undercrossings under Highway 101 are very critical to the community in having 101 not be a barrier, but be a place where you can actually get through. In terms of the safety aspect of it, this is a collision heat map using a tool by a Berkeley that's put out that shows just the pedestrian and bicycle collisions. The redder areas would be the places where you see the most reoccurring collisions. State Street corridor, as you can see, because it has the most bikes and pedestrians, has a great deal of collisions. And you can see the reddest portion is at that crossing in Highway 101. Just to give you the actual boots on the ground locations of the collisions in the last 5 years for bicycle and ped, this is what we're looking at. And it really has a lot to do with the street functioning more for speed, and it doesn't have the same feel you get when you're in the plaza where it's planted. It feels more like an open highway. So when we do have a collision, if it's at a higher speed, then it's more likely that there's going to be an injury or a fatality. Some of the measures that Derek Bailey, our traffic engineer, has been doing to specifically get that the intersection at Gutierrez, you can see that cluster of blue dots, the pedestrian collisions on that crosswalk. You can see we've highlighted the signal here. The signal's red, but the green, the walking man is on, which means what Derek's done is he's said, okay, pedestrians, get out in the crosswalk before we turn on the green signal so people see that you're actually there, trying to create more visibility. And then this additional signage yielding to pedestrians, and that has had some results, but because Gutierrez is one of the widest crossings of lower State Street, still improvement is needed. So for this undercrossing, if we were to envision a better way of allocating space, the idea that we're proposing from that community input is that we would take the space that's here now, and here's all the lane widths, the bike lane widths, the sidewalk widths, and you can see some percentage allocation there on the left of the space that's dedicated for each, and widen the sidewalks into the street. We would drop two of the lanes, and we'd go from five to three lanes, or four lanes with a median to three lanes. And Derek will explain how that will work and function from a vehicle's perspective. But gaining that pedestrian space to now 37% with a 15-foot wide sidewalk on both sides, the column would divide the space, but two people could pass each other, two sets of people walking. And then a wider buffered bike lane, the buffered treatment with a delineator is the safer design, which would create that bicycle safety. Incidentally, with these reallocation space percentages, when we did a count in 2013 of peak hour traffic, we also counted the pedestrians. And the pedestrian count was 43%, and the vehicle percentage was 47%. So the pedestrian volume in this section of the city is one of the highest pedestrian volumes, even close to the amount of cars that are on the street. So this is the reallocation that we're looking at. And just to give you an idea of how that would perform in terms of vehicles, we wanted Derek to walk you through it and how that functions and how that changes the vehicle transportation under the undercrossing.
Mr. Bailey.
Good afternoon. My name is Derek Bailey. I'm with the Public Works Department and the Traffic Engineering Group. So after we got the feedback from the public and their seemed to be this desire to provide for wider sidewalks, safer bicycle and pedestrian facilities, we wrestled with where do we get the space from in order to provide those facilities without affecting traffic capacity. And so I'll just walk you through what we came up with. Vehicle capacity on city streets, it's unlike a freeway. A freeway is all about how many lanes we have kind of from one place to another continuously, and anytime there's a change in the number of lanes, it creates a bottleneck. On city streets, it's all about the capacity at the intersections. So at this particular corridor, it's all about the capacity at Gutierrez Street, and it's all about the capacity at Yananali Street. So if I may borrow the mouse, thank you. If we start at Gutierrez Street and look at the existing lane configuration, there are two southbound lanes, two northbound lanes. One of those lanes is a left turn lane and one continues north. This section right here under the bridge is the section we're going to focus on. There's two southbound lanes, there's that painted median in the middle, and then two northbound lanes. Once we get south of the bridge, those two southbound lanes narrow from two, or merge from 2 to 1, as there's a single lane that continues on to the beach. So in order to gain the space for the wider sidewalks and bike lanes under the bridge, we just moved that merge point from south of the bridge to north of the bridge. So again, the number of lanes that we have at Gutierrez doesn't change. The capacity doesn't change. We're just moving that merge point. So now if we look at the lane configuration under the bridge, there's one southbound lane, two northbound lanes. That doesn't change at all, so northbound operations won't be affected. And then that single southbound lane would continue on to the beach. There is one operational scenario that's going to pop up very infrequently, though, but it is something just to go into this eyes wide open with. When there's a train crossing State Street, and particularly a long train, traffic does queue up back underneath the State Street undercrossing. Currently, with two lanes, there's room to stack about 60 vehicles between Yananali and Gutierrez Street. If we merge those two lanes into one closer to Gutierrez Street, then there's only room for about 40 vehicles instead of 60. Just to give you an idea of how frequently that happens, during the month of February, there was over 95% of the train crossings that went through were under 2 minutes. To do something like this would probably take 4 or 5 minutes. There's only a handful of crossings in the month of February that were that long, and about half of them were overnight. So as we look as to how do we allocate space, is the best use of that space providing stacking for 60 vehicles for a fairly infrequent event, or is it a better use of that space for facilities that can be used all the time? As Rob mentioned earlier, the intersection of State and Gutierrez has been the location of a number of pedestrian-involved collisions, particularly the south leg of the intersection. There's people westbound on Gutierrez that turn left to go towards the beach. We have taken a number of measures that Rob described. We have a leading pedestrian traffic signal interval now, as well as additional signage. But one thing that this project would accomplish is narrowing the crossing across here. Narrowing crossings is generally a good thing for pedestrians. It reduces the amount of time the pedestrians are in the street, which reduces what we call the pedestrian exposure. So that's the amount of time that they're in the street and exposed to traffic. So this would improve safety as well. Again, this is the map showing recent 5-year history of collisions in the corridor. You notice this cluster of blue dots here. Are those collisions at pedestrian-involved collisions at the State and Gutierrez intersection. The red dots are bicycle-involved collisions, and those would be made, bicycle safety would be made better by providing for wider bike lanes as well as a buffer between moving traffic and bikes. A local architect prepared this rendering of what State Street could look like. Obviously, this would have to go to the Historic Landmarks Commission, and they would weigh in on how to make this right in terms of the Santa Barbara look and feel. But I think this is a great illustration of just what possibilities are under there. And just from a perspective of moving people, it's really exciting to see that we could really improve mobility between two really important neighborhoods in the city.
Let me interrupt you. You have a question, Mr. Dominguez?
I do. Going back to the intersection, the westbound traffic on Gutierrez, I know in the past people have talked about rerouting or changing Anacapa between Haley and Gutierrez into a two-way because of the people who come circle around onto State Street. Would that impact collisions at this intersection?
Councilmember Dominguez, yes, it would impact. That's the 400 block of Anacapa Street that is being considered for converting it to two-way. It would improve the collision record there as well because it would reduce the demand on that intersection, would give people another way around the lower part of State Street area to avoid that intersection. So traffic volumes would decrease, and so it would stand to reason the collisions would decrease as well.
Is that something that we could do at the same time as this, or is that something that's better kept as a separate project?
For the purposes of the grant funding and how we propose to deliver the project, it would be best to separate them, but it could be separate and parallel, definitely.
Okay. Great, thank you.
The State Street Undercrossing project cost, we're currently estimating, is probably somewhere between $5 and $5.5 million. We've done preliminary engineering up to this point, and we think that's the probable cost. What we're proposing is to apply for an active transportation program grant this summer in order to fund the project. The grant would fund the majority of the project. If there are any aesthetic enhancements that the HLC requires, that would be a city responsibility. The active transportation program, they're focused on delivering projects that are going to improve mobility. You know, how they look are less important to the program. So that would be a city responsibility. Schedule-wise, if we're directed to apply for that grant and we're successful, we would begin design in the summer of 2019, and construction would probably begin around the summer of 2022. It would probably be a 3-year environmental and design period. The Active Transportation Program is a statewide program. It's very competitive. We've had good success in the past getting money from that program. One of the approaches that we have is we self-score all of our projects before we actually apply, just to know how competitive that we're going to be. This project, we believe, is going to be very competitive, and we also apply for projects that they're not necessarily competing against other city projects, but stand up on their own merit. Thank you. So our recommendation to the City Council is to adopt a resolution to include this project in the 6-year capital improvement plan. Direct your staff to work with Caltrans, as it is a Caltrans-owned facility, and as well to seek ATP grant funding this summer. Thank you.
Thanks. We'll take questions from the council. Mr. Rouse and then Ms. Sneddon.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Bailey, going back to the slide over showing the crossing of the railroad, at the UP, I know when we went through this talking about narrowing State Street south of the railroad tracks, do we go back out? You can't really tell from the slides. This stayed a two-lane configuration both ways? Because wasn't there some technical problem with the UP tracks while we needed to widen again after we narrowed to accommodate the railroad?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rouse, the planned configuration across the tracks will be one southbound lane and two northbound lanes. Which is how it exists today.
But that one southbound lane plus a turn pocket, right, to the station? Isn't there a right turn pocket plus the southbound lane?
Correct. And there will be with this project,
right,
as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there will be a total of three southbound lanes at the intersection. There'll be a dedicated left turn lane, a through lane, and a dedicated right turn lane.
Okay, very good. And then my next question was, one of the concerns that came up in the original plan of the lawn trot of the narrowing of State Street was about emergency egress. And so clearly we've already got a bottleneck between the beach and the railroad tracks. Does that play into any of the engineering concerns at all?
Councilmember Rouse, yes, it does. But as far as capacity goes, you're restricted by your most limited area of the corridor, which in terms of coming up from the beach is around Mason Street, that one lane section. So even with what we're proposing here, it does open up to three lanes. Northbound won't be affected at all. We'll be maintaining the existing two lane configuration as it stands today. We have discussed this project with the fire department as well, and their concern is actually getting down to the beach from the fire station one downtown. One of the things they like about the painted median right now is because they can bypass traffic, and that gives them a quicker way to get down to the beach. But just in talking to them, we're quite confident we can overcome that. One of the possibilities is that we can install a more sophisticated emergency traffic signal preemption system, so that even as the fire trucks are on their way down there, the light at Yan and Ollie can turn green and start flushing traffic out before the fire engine even gets there. So we're pretty sure we can overcome the technical issues with that.
Thank you.
Councilmember Sneddon.
I really appreciate this project. I just had two quick questions about the timeline for the design process. One is referring to the slide 23 compared to slide 24. And I understand that one is an artist rendering, but it has a very different height of the pedestrian walkway versus slide 24, which looks like it still has the elevated. And so that's one question, when would those decisions be made? And then the other question is from all of the input from the community workshop input regarding lighting, sound barriers, all of those other design elements. Would those also be coming in 2019, or how do those get incorporated at what point in the project?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Sneddon, it's just kind of the rendering that makes it look like the sidewalks are not as high off the roadbed, but it would be the same as it is today. The proposal is just to widen but not change the height. And then regarding the community workshop in terms of the arts portion, that's a parallel track. And I know Ms. Johnson is still working on the how we get that funded and preparing how we do that. This project is proposed, if we were successful, the grant would be out in 21, I believe we would be constructing, 22, 23. So there's two different ways of doing that. It depends on really what the art project is and how this project would impact that project. So without knowing yet what the art project is, we'll have to get there first. But Ms. Johnson's here if you have any questions specifically about that.
I do. I would like to hear an update.
Ms. Johnson, go ahead.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Sneddon. So we received a lot of input at the community workshop and lighting, sound, interactive components, and all of that is going to be used to inform requests for proposals. So that's really our next step, is developing an RFP, something that we can put out to artists, design professionals, and go review it also with technical experts to make sure we know what is capable, what the opportunities are there, what's possible in the space. So that's the next step in moving forward, to see, you know, what proposals we get back. And there are going to be a lot of opportunities for the public to get involved in weighing in and, okay, is this the right fit? Is this going to be what we're looking for in this space?
Okay. Councilmember Friedman?
Thank you for the presentation. I have a few questions. The first one is, if you could clarify how this project doesn't compete with other projects. So do we have other projects that are we're submitting for ATP grants? Because my understanding, I'll ask that first. So.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, we are planning to submit for grant funding for the Las Positas and MODOC bike path project. Currently, those are the only two projects that we're contemplating applying for at this time.
So would it be conceivable that if we had two projects, because this is a statewide grant, and that even if both qualified, they could end up pitting them against each other?
In that sense, they do compete against each other. In the broader sense of they're competing against all projects. A really good example is Cycle 3 of the Active Transportation Program, which was summer of 2016. That was right on the heels of the city's Bicycle Master Plan project. In that project, or in that grant cycle, we applied for the bike project on the west side of Santa Barbara and on the east side of Santa Barbara. So technically they were competing against each other, but independently they both scored well enough that they beat out a lot of other projects in the state. So if they were the very last two projects at the cutoff, they would be competing against
each other. They are, but okay, that clarifies it, because I was a little unclear. The other questions I have, one is, it seems like we can move forward with the mural and the lighting project simultaneously with this, which would address some of the issues, because I think there's two issues here, and one is the safety and one is the pedestrian, facility pedestrian. But the last one I have we done any, do we even do this sometimes where we cone off a street and we do traffic studies to show what it would actually look like under those scenarios, and have we done that yet?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, we do that. Yes, before we implement projects, we oftentimes go out and, even with cans of white paint, kind of draw on the ground how things are going to change, cone it off so we can understand how traffic will respond. We haven't done that here yet. We've only modeled it, but just as far from a capacity perspective, we're not changing the lane configuration at either end of the corridor, so we're quite confident in our assumptions.
And one last question. You mentioned UP. My understanding is that they're actually going to be increasing freight over time going down the next few years. The number of freight trains that's going to come through is going to increase. Did we go on the past, or did we look at those actual numbers for freight trains going into the future where they're going to be increasing capacity?
We've gone on past, but just to give you an order of magnitude as far as trains going through Santa Barbara. There's typically about 14 trains that go through in a day. There's usually only one northbound and one southbound freight train. Most of the trains that go through here are Amtrak. So even if they doubled their freight moving back and forth, it's a pretty small increase overall.
Thank you.
Councilmember Hart.
Yeah, can you help me understand better the distinction between the additional cost elements that might come from the Historic Landmarks Commission review? You know, is it brick sidewalks versus concrete? Is it ornamental iron? And what sort of order of magnitude would you imagine those costs be that would be on the city's capital infrastructure?
Councilmember Hart, that's exactly right. Brick sidewalks compared to more of a standard finish, decorative lighting more versus just a plain concrete pole with LED lighting, ornamental railings. Those are the type of aesthetic enhancements that the city would be responsible for. Just to give you an order of magnitude on brick sidewalks versus concrete, we think it's probably about a $300,000 to $400,000 cost increase for bricks versus concrete. That's probably the most costly item, but order of magnitude, we're probably looking at $400,000 to $500,000.
Thank you.
We'll go to public comment. Mr. Moldaver, you're up first. Then Dave Lombardi, Barry Remus, and Matt LaBrie.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. I'm Lee Moldaver, speaking as an individual, but also speaking as the former chair of your first Transportation Advisory Committee. And one of the things I remember talking to Mr. Dayton about when he was young, out of school and new to town, was the fact that the Caltranian vision of the 101 underpass was overimagined with the idea that if the city ever wanted to go back to 150,000 population, Caltrans would give us the scope and capacity to be able to do it. And I served the city in the 1980s and 1990s on a couple of advisory committees that interacted with Caltrans on the design. And Mr. Bailey was right. One of the last issues to be resolved was the stacking capacity for the freight trains as they went through town. But I would also point out, as Mr. Hart knows, that without Measure D and redevelopment, what we have there today and for these last 25 years would be even darker and gloomier and less used and less functional than it is today. And when Mr. Dayton came up for street improvements for the La Entrada project, and he demonstrated, as Councilman Ross indicated, that the number of lanes going to the beach and whether they're going straight or turning right or left determined how wide the street had to be and the number of lanes. It was the transportation equivalent in this room of Galileo dropping the two balls off of the tower to demonstrate the basic laws of physics. And nothing has changed. This is an underpass that is too big and too vehicle-oriented than this community needs. It divides the downtown from the waterfront. This is a terrific staff proposal. Nina Johnson has indicated there's tremendous community support for it.
Thank you.
I wholeheartedly endorse it. Thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Lombardi, come on up.
Madam Mayor, Council members, my name is David Lombardi. I'm Interim Executive Director for Downtown Santa Barbara, and we really support this project. Mr. Dayton and I have been talking about this for years, about the connectivity between Lower State Street and Upper State Street, especially when La Entrada was going to get all finished. And now it's a beautiful area down there, and we really need to fix this underpass. Ms. Johnson has done a great job with the community outreach, and we are looking forward to seeing what's happening down there. But one of the things we want to also look forward to is the safety of the pedestrians and the bicyclists that are going through here and coming up to Upper State Street and into the downtown corridor. But one of the more important things, too, is now with the new trains coming in, with all the people coming from the south, workers, we're going to have a lot more traffic, pedestrian traffic, going underneath that underpass in the mornings and in the evenings to get on the trains going down back down into Ventura County and south. So I just want to let you know that we are very much in favor of this. We're going to do everything we can possible to help this go through. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Remus, Matt LaBrie, and I think we have a couple of other slips. So, Mr. Remus, go ahead.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and council members. My name is Barry Remus, and I'm representing COAST, the Coalition for Sustainable Transportation. We emphatically, enthusiastically support this proposal. We think, one of the missing puzzle pieces to the State Street pedestrian and bike safety puzzle. And we have full confidence that staff has come up with a plan for how to make that puzzle piece fit. We are also very enthusiastic about seeing some of the other bicycle and pedestrian improvements that are happening around town, given in the wake of the Eastside pedestrian transportation plan, as well as the bike master plan update, including the lower Milpas sidewalk infills, the bridges on Montecito Yananali and Cacique y Soledad streets as well. It's very exciting. On Gutierrez specifically, we're encouraged by also seeing the installation of the curb extension solution. We think that that will help enhance pedestrian safety at that corner by reducing the distance pedestrians need to travel. It's a win-win for both for the pedestrians and also the motorists, because the motorists then don't have to wait as long for pedestrians to cross. And furthermore, there is no right-turning traffic coming out of Gutierrez, so that curb extension should not impede traffic in that area. Vision Zero. We're also very excited about the fact that that's coming to light, and the Vision Zero plan is about to be implemented or about to be approved, we hope. This plays right into that, to make sure that our engineering is supporting pedestrian and bicyclist safety every inch of the way. So thank you very much. We hope you'll endorse this.
Thanks. Mr. LaBrie?
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, council members. Thanks for taking a look at this project. I think it's really important. My name is Matt LaBrie. I'm with the Downtown Organization. And I just want to point out two things. This project really is an indication that the city understands and appreciates the need to reinvest in its downtown core. And the importance of this project is really going to signal to the community that you care about what's going on downtown. I think it's one of the great indications that you're leaning in and contributing, as we know you are. The other thing it's going to do is it's going to stimulate reinvestment in the area, and so that's really wonderful. So I want to echo all of the great comments about pedestrian and bicycle safety, and really taking a wonderful space and making it potentially a destination, but also point to the fact that you're going to trigger some really wonderful things and attention to that area. So thank you.
Thanks. Ed France and Sharon Byrne will be the final speaker.
Madam Mayor and Council, thank you and staff for pursuing this project. On two points, I'd like to address first safety. Harkening back to the bike master plan process with Peter Brown and all the staff looking at all the different collisions and our own volunteer, Dr. Dan Fishbein, looking kind of with an epidemiological approach. I could barely say that word. A lot of collisions on State Street. But this underpass specifically was where there was a heavily weighted amount of the severe collisions. Something to do with the underpass and maybe the descent and ascent and whatever the traffic flow, but there was a lot of the more severe collisions in this area. And so this, from a traffic safety for bicyclists, is really important. And then the second point about really connectivity of our community. We had a friend from Wisconsin, a family friend, staying in town. They stayed at the Fez Parker's Doubletree, and weren't able to hang out with him the first night. It was like, yeah, go to downtown. Just walk down, and then you'll get into the funk zone, and that's cool. But you can keep going. But here's the thing: you're going to have to go under the freeway. Do it. Go under the freeway, and then you will. Like, it's going to get cool again. And sure enough, the next day she said, yeah, you know, if you hadn't told me that, there's no way I would have walked under that bridge. And I think that both the aesthetic and the pedestrian bike enhancement for this bridge is going to be very meaningful for connecting under the 101 pinch point. Thank you.
Thanks. Ms. Byrne?
I'm happy to actually get the chance to sit through this item. I'm a person that lives around the corner from where this is going to be installed, two blocks away. And I typically take that underpass on the way down to Beachwalks early in the morning. It is not a pleasant experience, so this is going to be much better than it has been. And I want to actually thank the engineering guys for thinking about how to narrow State Street at Gutierrez, because I've been struck in that intersection at 6:30 in the morning. So to me, this is like just a win for the neighborhood and just a much nicer route. So kudos. Hope you do it. Good luck. And Ed France gave me the wrong item number. Sorry, Paul.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Hart?
Well, I think this is a great project and a great opportunity. 25 years ago, when I was on the Planning Commission, I opposed the design of this section of road, thought it should be two lanes then. And ironically, this is a great opportunity to fix that and to do it better than it would have been done 25 years ago, because the materials will be better. They will be more appropriate for Santa Barbara's high architectural and design standards, and it's going to be a really great connection to downtown. And as Mr. Lombardi said, we're going to have new train service here on April 2nd in the morning and the afternoon. There's going to be a lot of people getting off the train, walking to downtown, and the pedestrian connection on the sidewalk is woefully inadequate. Like Ms. Byrne, I've seen her down there at 6:30 in the morning walking on toward the beach. It's very narrow. It is inappropriate, and this will be a really spectacular project. And I think it'll compete really well at the state level with the active transportation program too. So having it paid for by the state, having it be high Santa Barbara architectural standards, and having it be properly sized for safety improvements is a great project.
Great. I didn't see who put their light on first, Mr. Rouse or Mr. Dominguez. Who was it? Mr. Rouse, go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Yeah, it's pretty rare that I'll advocate for narrowing a roadway, and even more strangely that I'm advocating for a, I won't say the B word, but a curb extension up there in Gutierrez. But they're both great ideas. My biggest fear in the La Entrada project coming to fruition was the stopping of Santa Barbara at the freeway. Mr. Francis pointed out, his friend, they get to the bridge and there's no compelling reason to go under it, and frankly, it is kind of dark and dank down there, and it's not very welcoming. To that end, I mean, this is when I first saw the project as put out by Mr. Bailey and Mr. Dayton, I was so excited because it really was things that I'd been thinking about for a long time, and boom, they'd already had it. It is a ways off when we have grant things to do and everything takes a long time. I'd love to see us somehow even bring in some small improvements beforehand, even if we can put in some temporary lighting to brighten it up in there, clean it a little more off. I know that the downtown organization does get in and do pressure wash in there, even to establish the pattern to get people to use that more frequently now, so as we complete this project, it'll be an improvement for people that are already using it. So lighting, I know that in the parking system, Mr. LeBrie knows this, we sometimes pipe in music to keep certain elements from not hanging out. So I think a loop of Barry Manilow's greatest hits would probably do that for us down there. That'll work well. But I'm excited about this. It's a great community project. Ms. Johnson ran a great, that little charrette we had with people coming together as the art community to have an exciting project to do. So I'd like to see this go forward as quickly as humanly possible. Good work.
Thanks. Mr. Dominguez?
I wonder who borrowed my CD and didn't give it back. I think it's a great project. It's a great project for my district, where it's a big chunk of my district is along there, and it's a great project for the city in terms of how it improves transportation and circulation, particularly safety. And someone mentioned Vision Zero, so our goal is to have zero traffic fatalities for pedestrians, bicyclists, and people driving cars and other vehicles. I do have one question. Do we have any transportation-related improvements related to the Amtrak and parking lot area?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Dominguez, you mean regarding the train coming?
Entry or exit from the parking lot. I know we've changed something related to the parking lot.
The only improvement that we have that we did recently was we added the railroad parking lot in front of the Fish Enterprise, and we incorporated that because now that lot on the weekends is full and is running at capacity. And then the other thing that we've done recently is we're working with MTD on the last mile of the train trip. So the buses will be staged next to the platform when the train comes in. And we're operationally making it so that the gate arms are not an issue so that the buses can get in and out really, really fast.
The idea to minimize the platform-to-platform commute for people switching modes of transportation?
That's correct.
Great. And where are we with parking capacity? Are those parking lots now maxing out?
They're maxing out. And just 2 years ago, they were half as full. So it's just a sign that the Funk Zone has a lot of parking needs. One of the things that the Downtown Parking Committee is looking at in that regard is to the Helena lot, which is on the Funk Zone side, which is about 29 spaces, and making that more convenient for the Funk Zone and how they use that lot, reserving it for customers. So the Downtown Parking Committee is looking at parking resources in that area.
And do we have designs in general for the depot there to either expand use or to bring more people there? I know a lot of cities, a lot of municipalities want to encourage transit-oriented development because it's part of what gets people on the trains to come up, which is our goal is to get some of our commuters from down south to take the train. So one idea is to add in more retail, or like you were suggesting, making the buses easier to access. Is there anything else going on that we should be aware of? And I'm really asking with the mind of when we do this grant, what would be another selling point, or is there an associated grant we should be looking at?
We could be thinking about opportunities with this grant. The only other thing I can think to tell you is that the Greyhound station is located in half of what's known as the REA building, which is an older railroad structure. And the other half of that building we're looking to lease this year. That's a downtown downtown parking controls the depot property and manages that. And we were waiting for the Entrada project and the Californian to get open and in so that we would get the most likely tenant that would have the highest, would work the best for the railroad depot. And so that's going to be happening in the next fiscal year.
How many square feet is that?
It's about 1,700 feet.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Mr. Friedman.
Well, I think this is a great project coming in. I had some concerns with it. One thing that when we talk about $5 million and going to the state, it's free money. Well, as my accountant's going to remind me tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., I'm a state of California taxpayer as well. So when we apply for grants, I hear that a lot that, we're not paying for it. But us, we are paying for that. But the comments today were really beneficial and the staff presentation as well to understand why we're doing it. And I especially appreciate Mr. Lombardi's comments about the new commuter rail coming in, because I think that's a key aspect of it, is we're going to have this new population of pedestrians, hopefully, that are going to be using this that we haven't had before. And that really resonated with me on this. I just feel overall, not this project, but government, we really need to look at costs for everything now, because we just don't have the resources we used to have. And so that's why I came in this looking. $5 million was a lot for a couple of blocks to me. But as I understood the project more and listened to my colleagues and the presentation today and the public comment, I really understood the value of this. And so I'll be supporting this. And I think it will ultimately, it will move up to where we want to go. And it'll allow us to continue moving up State Street as we look to what we're going to do beyond Gutierrez. So thank you.
Thanks. Well, I certainly support the project for safety improvement, downtown vibrancy, and it'll be a more inviting area for our tourists and our locals. And I'll entertain a motion. District 3 is also touching there, and Randy Rouse's District 2, but I get your point that it's a whole lot of District 1 right there, too. So, Mr. Rouse, you'd like to make a motion?
Whether I'm touching or not, I will move the staff recommendation, Madam Mayor.
Okay. That was a motion by Rouse and second by Dominguez. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed, I think. Okay, we like that one. Thank you. We'll move on to item number 10.
Item 10. contracts for construction of light industrial buildings at 6100 Hollister Avenue.
All right. Thanks, Mr. Bailey. Thanks, Mr. Dayton. And I think our airport staff is coming up here for this item. Are you Mr. Thomas?
Mr. Reynolds.
Oh, Mr. Reynolds. Oh. Forgive me, whenever you're ready.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, fellow council members. My name is Leif Reynolds. I'm an engineer at the airport, and I'm here today to give you a presentation of our 6100 Hollister Avenue project. This project is located off of Hollister Avenue, just right across the street from the project. As we can see, but airport administration is right across the street, and our project is in the orange. The project full build out is approximately 47,000 square feet. We have 9 buildings. It's bookended by David Love Place on the west and Lopez Road on the east. The new Wallace Becknell Road, which has been constructed but is not open yet, is just to the north of it, and Hollister on the south. We have retail bookending the corners at Lopez and Love, and the remaining 6 buildings are light industrial buildings. As you can see, they're partitioned into either 2 or 3 units, so it can have a single tenant or 2 or 3 tenants, depending on what they take. It's hard to believe, but I was here almost exactly 2 years ago talking about this project. And since that time, we did receive Planning Commission approval on October 6th in 2016. However, on October the 14th of 2016, the City of Goleta appealed the Planning Commission's approval. The City Council then denied the appeal on April 11th, 2017, and the City of Goleta then filed a lawsuit challenging the Council's approval. The lawsuit is still awaiting a court date. However, the City of Santa Barbara has decided to proceed with the project, as the lawsuit is regarding fees that the City of Goleta is charging, not the project itself. On January the 23rd, we received 2 bids for the project. Tomar Construction out of Santa Paula was the low bidder, $5,400,000, and Lash Construction here in Santa Barbara was the second bidder. Our engineer's estimate was pretty much right in the middle of those two. We're asking for council to award the construction contract today. Again, we have the full build out is 47,000 square feet. The bids allowed for the construction of building 1. That's the retail building. It has 2 components. That's on Lopez and Hollister. Building 2 is the next building to the west. It's 4,400 square feet, light industrial, 2 units. Building 3 is next to that, going to the west. It's also 4,400 square feet of light industrial space. It's important to note that this project and the bid not only covers the cost of the 3 buildings, but it also covers the cost for the stormwater treatment and landscape of the entire site. So our stormwater treatment will be constructed all the way from Lopez to David Love in front of the buildings and going up each side street. So that will be complete for the entire build out of the project in this phase. We're also constructing parking lots and the public sidewalk around our site, the off-site improvements, if you will, and street lighting. So that will all be constructed in this first phase. This is a rendering. It actually does have the 3 units that we're proposing to construct now. To the east of the slide, that's unit number 1, and you'll see that a little better in the next slide, and then buildings 2 and 3 are next to that. You can see it has a meandering sidewalk on along Hollister and access from Hollister. And this is a slide from Hollister at David Love. That would be the patio of a retail space, which we envision to be a deli or a coffee shop, something of that sort. That's just another view from Hollister at buildings 2 and 3. And then this last side has two elevations. The top elevation is a building. If actually we could look from our office there at Airport Administration across Hollister, that would be the full build out you'd see. To the right there is the retail building 1, and then 2 and 3 are next to that. It's kind of hard to see, but in wider kind of grayscale, you can see the direct relief building behind us. It pretty much occupies the entire block, and you can see our building's height in relation to theirs. And then the bottom slide is an elevation. It's from the east on David Love, and so our buildings are shown on Hollister in front, and the public road, Wallace Becknell, is just behind the trees you see, and then the direct relief building is just behind that. So that's what the block will look out with full building. So it was just a short presentation today. We have myself here and Ms. Johns, Airport Director, if you have any questions for us.
Thanks. Mr. Hart, you have a question?
So there's a total of 9 buildings, full build out, and these are the first 3. Why are you starting at that end as opposed to the other end?
Yes, Madam Mayor, Councilmember Hart, we wanted to start on the east end because access to the site from Hollister is easiest coming from the east to the west, and we want that first building to be, we feel it's going to be what you see first.
Okay.
So we're starting there and proceeding to the west. The 3 buildings were built, we did bid alternates, and those are what we could afford at this phase with the funds we have.
And that's the reason why only 3 of the 9 is a cash flow basis?
That's correct.
Timing.
That's correct.
And then what is the plan for the timetable for completion of the remaining 6 buildings? Is it over a couple of years or 5 years?
I will let Ms. Johns answer that question.
Great. Welcome, Ms. Johns.
Madam Mayor and Councilman Hart, the plan that the airport established was a development fund. And our goal is to take half of the revenue that we generate from the buildings that we are able to construct and put in the development fund. And should our revenues exceed operational expenses, and we have some left over, we could add to it. I think in this particular bid, the buildings themselves were not broken down by cost. Is that right, Lee?
Correct.
So I'm not exactly sure how much it costs to build a building. Mm-hmm. But we do have a plan, and it will take several years to get there.
I guess the good news is the first of the bid is about $1 million less than the engineer's estimate. Yes. So that's a great start to that whole process. And I understand the sidewalks and all the parking lots and all of the infrastructure is going to go in. What will happen with the lots that aren't going to have buildings on them? Will they just be graded and left alone, or is there a plan to do something in the interim time with those unbuilt lot
Councilmember
lot
Hart, what will happen is we're going to be constructing the parking lots approximately halfway across the site. The west side of the site will remain unchanged other than the stormwater treatment that's along Hollister. Mm-hmm. So there's an existing building there. I think we have Aero Camper Shell and San Marcos Farms. Okay. They'll stay in that building until we decide to move further west and construct additional buildings.
All right. That answers my questions. Thank you.
Mr. Casey, we don't have any speaker slips, and it doesn't look like there's any other questions from the council, so I need a motion, please. Mr. Dominguez.
Thank you. As the liaison to the airport commission, I was there for the meeting, and it was a pretty exciting presentation. I think there was buzz in the room. People were enthusiastic about seeing the bids and moving this forward. So with that, I would make a motion to approve the 4 staff recommendations and adopt them.
Very good. A second, please. A second from Mr. Rouse. Any other discussion? We'll take a roll call. Thanks.
Councilmember Friedman?
Yes.
Councilmember Dominguez?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Rouse?
Aye.
Councilmember Hart?
Aye.
Councilmember Sneddon?
Yes.
And Mayor Maria?
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously.
That's unanimous. Thank you. Thanks for your good work on that. The next item, number 11.
Item 11, designation of the Margaret Baylor Inn, Libero Building, the Live Oak Dairy, and La Arcata as city landmarks. Recommendations that Council A, adopt by reading of title only, a resolution of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara designating the Margaret Baylor Inn, Libero Building at 924 Anacapa Street as a city landmark. B, adopt by reading of title only, a resolution of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara designating the Live Oak Dairy Building at 901 North Milpas Street as a city landmark. And C, by adopt by reading of title only, a resolution of the Council of the City of Santa Barbara designating the La Arcata Building at 1110 through 1114 State Street as a city landmark.
Thank you.
I think.
Are you ready, Ms. Hernandez?
Yes, I am. Thank you. Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and council members. For the new members, I'm Nicole Hernandez. I'm the urban historian working with the design review section. And I have also here today Commissioner Grumbein from the Historic Landmarks Commission, representing the Landmarks Commission, if you have any questions. Just because we have some new members, we are going to add a brief presentation that we don't usually do, just describing our process, how we got here, very briefly. And then we will have, I review the candidates, the three candidates today for you and their significance. So to begin with, the regulatory authority for designating city landmarks is written into our charter, and it's outlined in the municipal code. It states that the Historic Landmarks Commission shall have the power and the duty to recommend to City Council that certain structures, natural features, sites, areas having historic, architectural, and archaeological, cultural, or aesthetic significance be designated a landmark. In addition, the identification and designation of historic resources is stipulated by the historic resources element of the general plan, which directs us to directs the continued identification, documentation, and designation of individual historic resources as well as historic areas. So the Historic Landmarks Commission designates a designation subcommittee that decides which candidates will be the next round for city landmark designations. The goal is to designate 6 landmarks per year. They are designated in batches of 3 twice a year, so you see me twice a year typically. They are chosen from the city's potential historic resources list. The California Environmental Quality Act requires that the city keep an inventory of buildings eligible to be designated as historic resources. This is our potentials list that was started in 1978 based on a historic resource survey and has been added to over the years. All items on that potential historic resources list are under the jurisdiction of the HLC. The Historic Landmarks Commission chooses the priorities for the buildings to be designated from the diverse heritage of the city. There are currently 129 city landmarks, and information on each and a photograph can be seen on our website in the Historic Resources Database. But we have schools, libraries, mid-century modern murals. It comes from a diverse array of things.
Ms. Hernandez, Mr. Dominguez has a question. By mistake. Okay. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So then the Historic Landmarks Commission holds a public hearing to consider recommending to City Council the designation of the historic structure as a city landmark. They review the criteria that make the building eligible as a resource as outlined in the municipal code and vote to pass the resolution to bring it forward to you today is how we get here. In addition to our guiding charter, municipal code, and historic resources element, the city is the lead agency for the California Environmental Quality Act. Buildings that are listed on the California Register or eligible for listing on the California Register are recognized as historic resources, as well as our own designated city landmarks and structures of merit, based on a preponderance of evidence that they are historic. And even if a structure is not designated a city landmark or structure of merit, we are still not free to ignore their historic significance when evaluating future projects. The building or nearby structures, the city has to determine whether the project will have a substantial negative impact. So what we are here is to do the official city stamp, city recognizing the historic importance of structures rather than leaving them in the gray area of the potentials list. So now I will start reviewing the three candidates for today. Our first candidate is the Margaret Baylor Inn.
It's now called the Libero Building. It qualifies for 6 of the criteria for the city landmark designation outlined in the municipal code. The building was constructed originally as just a hotel for single business women. In 1925, Julia Morgan came to design the building. She is one of the most important architects of our time, or her time. Julia Morgan was a trailblazer in architecture. She was one of the first women to receive an engineering degree from the University of California, Berkeley. She was the first woman to earn an architectural degree from the L'École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, and the first female architect to be licensed in the state of California. She oversaw 700 built projects in her career, including Hearst Castle. And in 2014, after she died, she did finally receive the gold medal from the American Institute of Architects. She was the first woman to receive this honor. She actually arrived in Santa Barbara to start designing this building on June 29, 1925, the day of the big earthquake. And the earthquake happened while she was waiting for a streetcar to come to the site. So the building is made of reinforced concrete. And so after the earthquake, the Community Arts Association did view this disaster as an opportunity to rebuild our downtown in the Spanish colonial revival, Mediterranean and mission styles. That reflects the heritage of the city. Her training in the Beaux-Arts is, style gives this building this formality that we see in symmetry, but it's excellently translated into the Italian Mediterranean style, a building just suited particularly for Santa Barbara. The building is located on Carrillo, just behind the Recreation Center, facing Anacapa. The proposed boundary of the city landmark designation is the entire lot, as it pretty much takes up the entire parcel. One thing from the aerial that you can see is the unique shape that the building has right here with this courtyard that allows not only for open space, but it allows light to get into the interior units, and it has elegantly designed terracotta roofs. This is a hand-colored postcard from the 1920s illustrating this subtle, understated elegance of this four-story building. The building embodies distinguishing characteristics that include the massing, the low-pitched roof, the overhanging eaves, the Roman arched openings on the first floor, as well as the symmetrically aligned windows and open loggia with ornate stone capitals. The housing for women was originally established in the rec center, and when that grew inadequate, Margaret Baylor, for whom the building was originally named, asked Julia to come and design a hotel for women. She herself was a women's rights campaigner, and the building was completed in 1927. By 1943, it was a hotel, but it was co-ed, and in 1958, it was home to 140 UCSB students waiting for the campus in Goleta to be completed, and now it's evolved into an office building that still has the same classical face as it did in 1927. Here you can see just some of the intricate details that Julia used to adorn the building to show some Spanish colonial revival references. You'll see the ironwork. There's this blooming flower at the end of the brackets and the delicate tracery along the railing and the beautiful carved stone capitals. She also employed swans that throughout the building as a unifying motif. You'll see in these intricate carvings of the grills on the front elevation and side elevations. Here you can see again from the side view how it has this beautiful courtyard that allows for open space and light to reach the units. It also has some really mature camellias that we think are original to the courtyard, and you can see the capitals even line the courtyard as well that mimic the capitals on the front elevation. This is an early photograph illustrating some of the early plantings. You can still see that there's a little Italian cypress here that is now a big Italian cypress. And there's some agave plants and yucca gloriosa that are still in the planting beds. And this is another historic photograph that shows a flowering vine across the facade. I don't think it's the same as the bougainvillea currently, but that has traditionally been on the building since it was constructed. And now I'll transition into our second candidate for city landmark to designation, and that's the Live Oak Dairy. This meets 6 of the city landmark criteria outlined in the municipal code. In 1939, the Live Oak Dairy was constructed when there were over 10 dairies operating in and around the city. The building was the Live Oak Dairy's new creamery and processing plants, and the owners hired Alex D'Alfonso to design and construct the building. The owners bought the plaster cow from Alfred Kuhn, a sculptor in Yucaipa, California, for $1,000 and placed it on the roof over the entrance. Later, the building became home to McConnell's Dairy, an ice cream shop, and as most of us know, it is a tradition for the high school students to paint and costume the cow. And the building has now been converted into a restaurant. The building sits on the corner of Milpas and Perdido Streets. The building is really an anchor on Milpas, which is a combined industrial, commercial, and residential buildings. The proposed boundary of the designation is the entire parcel, as it takes up most of the parcel, and it will also be the first designated landmark on Milpas Street. The building is designed in the streamlined modern style, which was prevalent from 1930 to 1945. Streamlined modern is inspired by a machine aesthetic. As the world transitioned from the exuberance and richness of the 1920s and into the grips and austerity of the Depression, the high-style architects were pushed aside for these industrial designers. These designers began to favor simpler aerodynamic lines in the forms of modeled ships and airplanes and automobiles. You'll see smooth surfaces and curved corners and an emphasis on horizontal lines that give the feeling that airstreams could move smoothly over them. This aesthetic was put in service in all sorts of architecture like roadside diners, motor hotels, cinemas. This building in particular has the streamlined, modern, rounded canopy, as well as these fluted pilasters and the band of the block windows and vector lines, giving it this horizontality. The building's designer, Alex D'Alfonso, was born in L'Aquila, Italy. He moved to Santa Barbara in 1915. He had a design and contracting firm that was active from 1921 to 1978. During his long career, he did Spanish colonial revival buildings to mid-century modern buildings. He did large commercial projects, and he did entire residential tracts. This is an early example of his drawings, and you'll see that not much has changed from the original drawings. He also designed this as a flyless dairy, which was revolutionary, according to research, which are these rectangles. Apparently, air goes through the ceiling, discouraging flies from congregating. And as you can see from this photograph taken on opening day compared to its current appearance, the building has retained high integrity and is able to convey its original appearance and has its original design, materials, and workmanship. And our final candidate today is La Arcada. La Arcada, as most of you know, is on the corner of State and Figueroa Streets. It was designed as a shopping and destination center to be part of Santa Barbara's Paseo system, complementing the first Paseo on State Street, El Paseo, which was designed to mimic a small Spanish street. La Arcada building qualifies for four of the criteria outlined in the municipal code. Although Myron Hunt is credited with the design, officially he was consultant to John Cooper, the architect of record. A note, as noted earlier for the Libero building, after the earthquake, the Community Arts Association envisioned this Mediterranean Spanish colonial revival city to reflect the heritage of the city. Myron Hunt was one of Southern California's most accomplished early 20th century architects, and he created some of Southern California's most iconic architectural structures, including the Huntington Library and the Pasadena Rose Bowl. Santa Barbara's fortunate to have a few of his masterpieces in downtown, included in our architectural repertoire, including Santa Barbara County Bank, the San Marcos Building, and the Faulkner Gallery, all of which are designated landmarks. Here you can see the Paseo. This is a 1920s picture of it, and here you can see an aerial view of the Paseo running in this L shape from State Street all the way around to Figueroa Street. The building was noted as an innovative departure from traditional pattern of urban buildings, which were just oriented to the street. With its pedestrian-oriented Paseo through the center of the building, having this anchor of the fountain in the center, in this octagonal plaza. It is also the focal point of both paseos leading from State and Figueroa Street. Note it also has beautiful terracotta parapets and towers with gables and hipped roofs. Here you can see, looking down the paseo from State Street, the restaurant space behind the Turtle Pond, It was, in this photograph from the early 20s, it was known as Russell Fine Foods. It still has the arched windows with the heavy sills and corbels in place and still is used as a restaurant space. The Larcadas exemplifies the Spanish colonial revival style. It's an outstanding example of important architectural style to Santa Barbara. With this, it has emphasis on interplay of cubic volumes as the building has these diagonally cut corners and these beautiful bridges crossing above the paseo. In addition to its grandeur and importance of the front elevation with these large openings. Larcadas' success, both that as a urban space and retail center since 1926, is due to the pedestrian-friendly scale established in the arcades and the paseo by the sense of enclosure created by the walls, bridges, columns, and ceilings. The thick plaster walls are contrasted by these subtle details of the thick lintels and the timbered ceilings over the arcade. And that concludes my presentation. And the recommendation from the Historic Landmarks Commission is that City Council adopt resolutions to designate the Margaret Baylor Inn, Libero Building, Live Oak Dairy, and La Arcada as city landmarks.
I'll start with a question, Ms. Hernandez. I understand that the third property, the owners do not support a designation, right?
They sent a letter to the Landmarks Commission saying they did not want to be designated.
The other two, the owners, are saying yes.
Yes. I believe they might be here. They're here. And
that's what I saw on the report. Yeah. How often does it happen that an owner says, I don't want this designation?
It's typically when we send notice that we're going to start the landmark process, almost every owner is concerned. Needs to understand the implications. And usually they call me like, why? And then when we explain this honor and that most of them have to go through CEQA and are on the potentials list, that this is just giving the final seal of the honor, they understand that this is more of a ceremonial item now rather than having implications on their property.
Okay. I'm not entirely comfortable if the owners don't want it myself. I don't know what my colleagues are going to say, but it's not like I got a letter from the owner saying don't do it. So I'm not being heavily lobbied. But La Arcada has a great reputation. Their tenants are really happy there. I understand they charge reasonable leasing costs, and everybody's very happy there. So I'm sort of not wanting to... I offend them. I'd like to honor their request, but so I'm stuck a little bit here because I'm not, like I said, I'm not getting much lobbying, but maybe someone's in the audience. Do we have any speaker slips? None at all. Okay. Any other questions? Ms. Sneddon and then Mr. Hart.
Well, I guess the question, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think she had her light on first. I'm trying to do the person who has their light on first.
I believe we did all receive a letter. Did we not all receive a letter from attorneys representing the in protest of it being designated historic landmark? And are we just asking questions now or comments?
Yes, ma'am. This is questions. Yeah.
Okay. I have no other questions.
Madam Mayor.
Oh, Mr. Hart. Mr. Casey.
Yeah, sorry. We do have a member of HLC here who might want to be able to speak to the designation process of HLC's perspective and address that question as well. So Mr. Grambean's here.
Very good. Mr. Grumbine, are you ready to make a comment?
Yeah.
Okay.
Madam Mayor, council members. So this was for HLC's point of view, we had a similar sort of concern as well in terms of it not being, normally they're very much wanting to be part of the process once they understand it. And one of the sort of key things in our mind as we were discussing it was one notion that Jaime Limon, the late great, or just the great, would explain it that the only real difference when you have a great architect doing a great building and you want to do something to it and work with it, which is pretty much all buildings, then the only difference between having a landmark and having just designated as a historic resource is that the landmarks can't be destroyed. So if you want to demolish something, if it's a historic resource, It can. There's processes that can be gone through. If there's a landmark, it can't be destroyed. So that's really, in terms of the scrutiny or the care in which everyone looks at it, in terms of what was the architect and what was important about the building, in all cases, it's the same. It gets reviewed in the same process. It'll go through a Historic Landmarks Commission, obviously, if it's a historic building. If it's not a historic building, it's going to go through a different commission, ABR or Single Family Design. So in terms of the review level, a lot of times applicants don't understand that it is going to be reviewed the same no matter what, if it was done by a historic architect. Just as a sort of little side note, with La Arcata, there's an art appreciation for great buildings, which the city has a very high level of, which is fantastic. In another sense, sort of a practical sense, La Arcata has been very recently used. It was one of the examples put together for the AIA State Street in the booklets that you all received a number of months ago. It was one of the great examples of 80% or so density over a lot with 3-story plus, 40 some feet tall, as a fantastic, great, high density space that we can look at now as a way of emulating what our great city has. So on one hand, they're great as appreciation, but they actually are kind of our continued teachers as well, from the architect side of things and from the professional side of things. And it was interesting that 2 out of 3 of these buildings that you saw today are pretty tall and are pretty heavy lot coverage and are kind of some of the best that we have in terms of buildings. So on that side as well, just sort of as a personal side, it's a great lesson for us to continue to appreciate. So that's sort of from the HLC side of things, that's how we saw the importance of our landmarks. So,
Ms. Sneddon, did you have a question for Mr. Grumbine?
I do have a question.
Yes.
If there's no material difference other than the ability to demolish, I just had some specific questions about
it.
I mean, I think the La Arcata property has been owned by the same family for many years, and in my view, they've been most excellent stewards of that property, but not just that, but visionaries also. So I had questions about, say, when they put the statues in. Mm-hmm. Is that something that, once it's designated a landmark, would have been prohibited or restricted, or what types of restrictions as they're visioning? I mean, I believe they're real leaders in their visioning of the space. What types of restrictions would they have on carrying those out?
In practically speaking, really no difference. The analysis that happens with any historic building is, who was the architect? What are all the reasons that's important? If it was an important architect, if an important event happened there, if it was a perfect example of a certain style, if it was very innovative in its other way. So all the criteria that are laid out are what the actual building is. There isn't it's a landmark, therefore you can't change it at all mentality. It's very much I want to change this aspect of the building or this part. This is what's most important about it because of these reasons, and then you work from there. So you can change landmarks. You can change historic resources. Landmarks usually, there are historic resources that could be landmark because they're of that high quality. They're going to be treated as a high quality historic building when they come in, no matter what. If they are a high quality historic building, they're going to be treated as that for the reasons that they are high quality. And then we have the historian's report that identifies certain, like, oh, they have all these windows are the same, and they were a really neat, innovative way at the time that this architect did it. Well, that's going to be noticed no matter what. So if you want to change those windows, then at least addressing that issue is important. And one of the sort of pros, actually, which I didn't mention, was that as a historic landmark, this is just for the first time starting has happened, and you saw it with the copper coffee pot. There's been one commercial building that's actually been the Mills Act, which is as you all know, sort of incentive for caring for historic buildings that are important to us. Up until now, it's been residential, but there's now been one commercial building that's actually been able to apply for the Mills Act and get some sort of tax reprieve because they're putting money into a building that's historic and great and important to the city. So, not that all historic buildings will get that, but at least you have an option as a property owner if you want to do something to this building and you have to change all your plumbing and all your electrical and all your everything to keep this building running well. Then that can be part of a Mills Act application that landmarks are sort of seen as the sort of the best of the best. So it has a benefit in that way.
Thank you.
And then quickly, do we have a sense of why the property owners in this case are not supportive of the designation?
Everything from the letter indicated the regular concerns that property owners have when they see that, and it shows up in the mail that that their property is being viewed as a historic resource or possible historic resource. All those same concerns of, I can't do anything to it because it's now landmarked. I can't do any, if I want to go do anything, addition, change, whatever, it's going to be this massive process. The process won't be any different. They're already a historic resource. They're going to be, if they want to go do anything, they want to change all their shop windows, they're going to go through the same process that everyone goes through the building department, and they're going to have a historic resource report, and it's going to come to HLC. But that's going to be no matter what. And a lot of people don't understand that, when they...
Ms. Hernandez, did Mr. Grumbine represent that correctly?
Yes, I believe so. They felt like it might be some additional financial or cause more extensive review, but because they're already in EPV, they're under the Historic Landmarks Commission purview, they're considered a historic resource for CEQA purposes, they will always go through the same review that they go through now.
Okay, very good. Ms. Sneddon, are you good? Mr. Kalan?
I wanted to emphasize that the real constraint for the La Arcata is the California Environmental Quality Act. It's been made very specific over the years that negative impacts or impacts to a historic resource are significant and an environmental impact report needs to be done. So that's there whether we do anything or not.
Okay. Mr. Hart and then Mr. Dominguez.
Has there been any direct conversation with the property owners from staff or folks from the landmarks?
Thank you, Madam Mayor and council members. I have tried several times to set up an appointment, and they've not been responsive to doing okay. So.
Well, I share Councilmember Sneddon's concerns about this particular property owner because of they have been incredible stewards of this property. And I understand that it really is the duty of the Historic Landmarks Commission to recommend landmarking properties like this. But I think, Mr. Grumbine, you're incredibly eloquent champion for Santa Barbara's historic resources. I love your pieces in NewsHawk that's talking about the urban core. Ms. Hernandez, your staff reports are positively lyrical. I always enjoy these moments when we're landmarking things. I just would encourage you to somehow reach out to them in a way that you can explain this process better to them and that we take the time to pause to let that happen. I don't ever recall a building being landmarked without the consent of the property owner in my time here. I might be wrong about that, but I think that's a big deal. I think that there's a lot of symbolism involved in this. I don't think it has a practical effect. I think you've convinced me of that, but we need to be careful about this in this particular instance, and I would personally think we should take this recommendation off and approve the other ones.
Mr. Dominguez?
I don't have any questions for the speaker, but I'm ready to make a motion. Okay. Unless someone has further questions for the speaker.
Okay. So, Mr. Casey, how we usually do this, we take the vote, and then we present the proclamations.
Yeah, Madam Mayor, I would take your action on the three different recommendations however you see fit, and then those that you approve, you've got proclamations to hand out to the property owners after the fact.
Thanks. Mr. Dominguez, can I ask you to do number C differently or separately?
Sure.
I'll be voting against the designation.
So, and I just wanted to preface this by saying, as a liaison to the HLC, they've done amazing work, and our historians done lyrical work. This is one of our favorite presentations to see throughout the year. And I think we all agree we owe it to these folks, but all of our stakeholders in Santa Barbara to try to get them through the process as fast as we can. And that's something that I think our department's always striving to do. They've taken some steps. I think this is probably outside of the Accelerate District, but there is an Accelerate program on State Street. There's a survey now on the Development Department's website where people can put in their feedback on development. So we're constantly striving to do better, but I think we can really push it a little further. So I'd like to recommend that we adopt, by reading of title only, the resolutions related to the Libero building and the Live Oak building.
Second. That was seconded by Mr. Hart. Any other discussion? Let's do a roll call.
Councilmember Friedman?
Yes.
Councilmember Dominguez?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Rouse?
Aye.
Councilmember Hart?
Yes.
Councilmember Sneddon?
Yes.
And Mayor Maria?
Aye. Okay. That was unanimous for those two. Mr. Dominguez?
I'd like to move that we adopt by reading of title only a resolution approving the La Carta building as a city landmark.
Is there a second to that? That dies for lack of a second. Oh. Ms. Hernandez, if you'll take care of that accordingly. Oh, Mr. Hart.
Yeah, I would just, rather than this ending here, I would just encourage, you know, trying to meet with the property owners and see if we could talk through this. I think this building is a landmark, and I think that the property owners recognize it as a landmark. We just need to have a little bit more conversation to have them be in agreement to make it an official city landmark, and that would be a great result at the next time we see these enthusiastic people about these important issues.
Mr. Rouse has a comment.
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Hart. I think reaching out to the family, the Peterson family has been the absolute gold standard when it comes to being landlords, and so I don't want to take an opportunity away to have them input and then give their reasons why that they did not be a wanted landmark.
And Mr. Dominguez, anything else to add?
No, thank you.
No, okay. I'll come right on down. This is for the Libero building, the Margaret Baylor Inn and Libero building. What's your name?
Denise Elifendi.
Denise. Nice to meet you. Thank you. Okay. Whereas on December 13th, 2017, the Historic Landmarks Commission adopted resolution number 2017-116 to recommend to the City Council designation of the Margaret Baylor Inn Libero Building as a city landmark, and whereas the Italian Mediterranean style building was designated in 1926-27 by Julia Morgan, one of the most important architects of her time, as a hotel for businesswomen, and whereas the building's composition, massing, and simplicity are exemplary elements of design with the unifying motif of swans, I love that, featured in the Capitol columns, grills, and keystone over the front entrance, demonstrating outstanding attention to detail, materials, and stone craftsmanship. And whereas the building has retained a high level of historical integrity as its location, setting, association, design, materials, and workmanship have not been diminished, and the building conveys its original 1927 appearance. And whereas the City Council of Santa Barbara found the building meets six of the city landmark criteria listed in section 22.22.040 of the Santa Barbara Municipal Code, and whereas on March 6, 2018, the City Council of Santa Barbara adopted a resolution designating the Margaret Baylor Inn Libero Building as a city landmark based on its historical and cultural significance. Now, therefore, I, Mayor Kathy Murillo, on behalf of the City Council of the City of Santa Barbara, do hereby declare the Margaret Baylor Inn Libero Building as a city landmark effective March 6, 2018. Here you go. Would you like to say a few words?
Oh, I find all of this very interesting. We've owned the building since 1976, and my sisters and I hope that it meets, you know, Santa Barbara's wonderful downtown expectations. We are trying to keep her and move her into the next century in a way that our tenants are happy. And anyway, thank you for this.
A representative from the Live Oak Dairy here. Come on up. Mr. Coltiar? How do you say it? Nice to meet you. Thank you. Whereas on December 13th, 2017, the Historic Landmarks Commission adopted resolution number 2017-117 to recommend to the City Council designation of the Live Oak Dairy Building as a city landmark. And whereas the streamlined modern style building was designed in 1939 by Alex De Alfonso, a noted builder and contractor, in Santa Barbara as a Live Oak Dairy Creamery and Processing Plant. And whereas the building is distinguished with its canted front entrance with a round awning, rounded engaged columns, and stepped piers rising to the central platform that supports the iconic cow statue. And whereas the building has retained a high level of historical integrity as its location, setting, association, design, materials, and workmanship have not been diminished, and the building conveys its original 1939 appearance. And whereas the City Council of Santa Barbara found the building meets six of the city landmark criteria listed in section 22.22.040 of the Santa Barbara Municipal Code. And whereas on March 6, 2018, the City Council of Santa Barbara adopted a resolution designating the Live Oak Dairy Building as a city landmark based on its historical and cultural significance. Now, therefore, I, Mayor Kathy Murillo, on behalf of the City Council of the City of Santa Barbara, California, do hereby declare the Live Oak Dairy Building as a city landmark. Congratulations. Thank you.
We're newcomers to Santa Barbara, and we just bought this building 3 months ago. So this was a lucky coincidence for us. But we promised to take care of the cow, and I think it's supposed to be white, but with the exceptions when the high school kids paint it. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks. Ms. Hernandez, is your item completed then?
Okay. You know, Madam,
Mr. Casey.
You know, it might be helpful just for a record to take a motion on item three, just so there's a clear record about why you didn't take action today. So that just might be my suggestion on...
Mr. Hart?
So are you looking for something like a motion to table the designation of the landmark?
Exactly, okay. And to ask staff to reach out to the property owner to try to get their concurrence.
There you go. So moved.
Motion by Hart, second by Rouse. Any discussion? All in favor? Aye. Thank you. That was unanimous. Thank you, staff, for working so hard on those matters. Thanks. And the next item, please.
Item 12, request from Council Members Dominguez and Sneddon regarding option to join Clean Power Alliance.
Okay, so what happens when two council members bring an item, they present it to the rest of us, and it looks like you have a little staff support on this one, or questions. We have staff here in case there's questions as to the item. Mr. Dominguez, are you ready?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
So the item presented per council member is to explore the option of joining the Clean Power Alliance. The I guess I'll start with the goals I had in mind. There's eight of them: to lower energy rates, create greater energy choices, and the choices that we would increase would be the opportunity to use solar power, wind power, geothermal, bioenergy, and small-scale hydroelectric. The third goal would be to increase electrical rate price stability, to address climate change and reduce greenhouse gases, to create jobs in the local economy and the regional economy, to encourage local green energy projects. And then the final argument, if none of those seven were compelling, was that the entire state of Texas has energy choice, and they're as pro-oil as you can get. So if it's good for the pro oil state, it's good for us. The these eight goals that I mentioned, I think, are goals that consumers understand, our residents understand, we understand, and then how that handshakes with our city's general plan is with our environmental plan and our economic development plan, and that's to create a vibrant and economically sustainable commercial, industrial, and retail industry, and that is achieved by the lower and more stable energy costs, improve our infrastructure and natural resources, again, the infrastructure of utilities and energy and natural resources. This is to preserve the resources we have that would be harmed potentially by increased fossil fuel usage. It ensures the development and long-range conservation of coastal assets. It furthers our sustainability goals, particularly our goal by 2030 to have 100% renewable energy, and by 2020 to have 50% renewable, which is only a year and a half off. And it protects our ocean and waterways. So those are the reasons. Now, we've discussed community choice aggregators in the past. We've looked at studies or paid for studies to look at what the impacts would be and whether it would be feasible for us to run one on our own. So I think we are familiar with it. Just to go a little into the history, these types of organizations were allowed starting in 2002 with Assembly Bill 117, signed by Jerry Brown. The first city or area to implement one was in Marin, and that was in 2010, just to show kind of where we are in the history of these concepts. And at this point, I believe there's nine currently existing in the state. So that's the basic information. So I would ask
Ms. Sneddon if she had something to add.
I would just like to add that all of this on the first appearances looks so great to me, and I would request that it's not a motion today, but that staff can weigh in on that also, because I'm out of my depth in comparing this to community choice, comparing this to what we already have midstream. And I know you were kind enough to take some time with me to give me background, and my purpose for bringing this today is to keep the conversation open to see how we could have this expedited, what options we can be looking at the same time in case community choice does not turn out to be economically feasible. And again, it's compelling. And we also received a letter from Sierra Club in support. And do we all receive a copy? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And for those reasons also, I find it compelling to keep this option open and to investigate it further.
Okay. I'll ask a question of Mr. Ford then. The City Council has expressed interest in community choice energy or community choice aggregation, and we had a pursuit of that going, correct?
Madam Mayor, that's correct. We, for almost 2 years, looked into it, community choice energy at the county level, actually at the tri-county level from San Luis Obispo through Ventura. We looked at eight different geographic scenarios within those three counties. We brought the results of the feasibility study to council in October. According to the initial feasibility study by Wildan and Associates, and also the peer reviewer MRW, they both found to different extents that community choice would be pretty tough. What they concluded is it's hard to compete with Edison in Southern California. And so your council directed us to go and do a little bit more due diligence, which we're in the process of doing now, to look at some of the big drivers that influence that outcome. And so we are in the process of doing that with a consultant that actually makes power purchases and structures those sort of decisions on behalf of eight of the nine existing CCAs. And we hope to have the results by the end of April. And we'll be bringing those back to the Community Choice Energy Ad Hoc Subcommittee of Council and then ultimately to Council.
Okay, very good. I don't see any lights on, so I'll open public comment.
Jose, Madam Mayor.
Oh, I'm sorry.
One thing I wanted to mention is the interim director of Clean Power Alliance is here. He drove up from Los Angeles, so I imagine he's available for questions, or I'm not sure if he's submitted a public comment speak.
Oh, what's his name? Sorry.
He did not submit one.
He didn't fill
So I don't know if people would want to hear from him, maybe a short introduction before public comment or after, whatever you think is more appropriate.
Sure, let me ask. So the Clean Power Alliance, Mr. Four, would be an option on the track we were already on? But it's not excluded, right?
Madam Mayor, the Clean Power Alliance was formerly the LA County Community Choice Entity, and so it's about 30 jurisdictions currently that have joined together in a fairly large JPA. It's something that we discussed with the CCE ad hoc committee as a who is out there, who's forming up, and some different JPA models, but it's not something that your council directed us to specifically investigate. So I've spoken to Mr. Giroux a couple of times, but we haven't done any sort of in-depth analysis.
Very good. Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Ford, is our the way we structure our utility users tax, is that affected at all by these kind of choices? Does that play in?
Madam Mayor, Councilman Rouse, it is not. It would not. The franchise fees and things would not be impacted by this.
So no matter who the supplier of the power was, we still have the same franchise fee structure?
That's correct.
Okay. Mr. Giroux, did you want to come up? And you have 2 minutes to tell us about your program, and please fill out a speaker slip because we need that. Thank you.
Thank you very much,
please,
Madam Mayor.
Ahead.
Members of the City Council, appreciate the opportunity to be here today. Really want to just talk a little bit about what the program is. It has expanded. We have almost all of Ventura County now as well, 7 of the 10 cities, all of probably 95% of the population. So it's clearly a program that has gone regional, and it is up and running today. We are delivering electricity, actually started on February 1st, and delivering that electricity at 2% below Edison's rate, and that's at the 60% renewable level. We've built a program that is flexible for communities, so each individual city decides for itself what the default offering is to its residents and businesses. Of the 31 jurisdictions, at this point, 5 have elected 100% renewable as the default offering. Customers have the ability then to opt down to either the 50% level or the 36% level. The vast majority have selected 50% renewable as their default offering, and that's being offered at 3% below Edison's current rates. And at the 36% level of renewable, we're at about 4% below Edison's rates. The program is rolling out in phases. So the first phase is sort of a pilot phase where LA County's facilities only are in the program to test the transition. We have about 2,000 electrical accounts in the County of Los Angeles in the unincorporated areas. And so those are the ones being served today. Starting in June, we'll start serving commercial and industrial customers, and then rolling out to residential customers after that. So we are the board of the JPA is in regular meetings. They actually had a special meeting this afternoon, but the board is formed, starting to set policy. One of the things that we didn't do as staff as we were designing the program, developing the program, was make policy decisions. We said continuously that we're building the governance of the Joint Powers Authority, and the governance will drive the policies. So to date, we have not set policy for local renewable development or procurement, customer programs, any of those things that are going to be tailored to local communities.
Thank
so
you.
So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Ms. Madden has a question for you. Go ahead.
Thank you. Could you speak to what the sources of the energy are, where they're being produced?
For this first phase, what the board said when it was setting a sort of power procurement philosophy was, first of all, no nuke and no coal. Indicated we are at 60% renewable. The vast majority of that is within California renewables, solar and wind and geothermal. And then actually on top of that, there's hydroelectric. Hydroelectric does not count as a renewable in California under renewable portfolio standard requirements. So we've got 60% renewable and another 25% hydroelectric, all of it in the West Coast and delivered through the grid. We're not using what are known as renewable energy credits from sources that we don't actually get the electricity.
Mr. Dominguez?
I wanted to ask about the financing and the funding at the beginning and the startup and what kind of LA County is picking up versus what the other cities were coming in, like at the phase we would come in, would be liable for.
Sure. So to get the program started, the County of Los Angeles offered the program a $10 million loan, interest-free, and so it is using that money and said to cities that if you join us before the end of 2017, there will be no cost for you to join. The board of directors of the JPA then extended that by 3 months for communities affected by the wildfires, mm-hmm. mostly because several Ventura County cities were in process, and so they've now all joined. If Santa Barbara were to join before the end of March, then it would be covered under that, and while I can't speak for the JPA board, I would expect that there would be special consideration given to the city of Santa Barbara, given the not only the fires, but of course the mudslides that followed. So I would expect, but I can't guarantee, that there would be no cost to join after March 27th, but certainly before March 27th, you would be included in that. As a result of recent PUC resolution, however, cities that join after March 1st, but before the end of this year, cannot start service of electricity until January of 2020.
Thanks.
So anyone who joins after March 1st, so in other words now, would have to wait a year past this upcoming January.
Unless we were able to seek and obtain a waiver from the PUC resolution, and there is a waiver process, so that is something that's possible.
Okay. And then when does your board meet next, and what would be our process if this council chose to make application? What would be the process?
So our board next meet in regular session on April 5th. They meet the first Thursdays of every month, and they do allow for remote participation. So we have people calling in. Some folks gather at the Ventura County Hall of Administration, most of the Ventura County cities. If you were interested in joining, at this point the board has not affirmatively said we want to expand beyond Ventura. So if you were interested in joining, we would bring to the board at the April 5th meeting a notice that the city of Santa Barbara were interested. The board would then decide on a couple of things. One, whether the waiver itself should be extended, or if you had already acted before that date, but hadn't adopted the second reading of the ordinance and hadn't actually signed the JPA, whether you should go ahead and do that. And barring that, they would also, and if they were open to it, and I think they probably are, although I can't speak again for the board, then they would extend that invitation and say, you're welcome to join.
So. And just to be clear, the board is the representative from each of the cities, the council member or supervisor, as the case may be, from each member?
That's right. Under the JPA, it's a one-member, one-vote structure. So the County of Los Angeles has one vote, just as the city of Ojai has one vote.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thanks. So we have our own process going, and we're in partnership with other people, so we would need to check in with them. So we could join later if
sure.
we wanted to. Okay, good. Thanks. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Well,
just to clarify that, we could join subject to their board's approval.
Right.
But if we join after the end of March, then we would probably be paying startup costs or some fees that you guys are waiving up until the end of the month.
Right. Although I think, as I indicated, I think the board would be sympathetic to continuing to waive those on your behalf for some period of time, obviously not for the entire year, but given circumstances here, I think the board would probably be willing to grant some extension, 30 or another 60 days, something of that nature. Thereafter, there is a provision within the Joint Powers Authority that says the board may charge new members when they join. We adopted a policy or process for that, and I think I've shared that with staff, but I'm happy to share that with all of you as well.
Thank
Great.
You so
Thank
much.
You.
Okay, Jose Arturo Gallegos. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Sneddon, did you have a question for that gentleman?
No,
Mr. Jarrell, is it?
For staff.
Oh, for staff.
Yeah.
Okay, question for staff. Sorry, Jose.
Thank you. I'm just interested in how much time it might take to compare this option in terms of flexibility, the rates, long-term obligation, and risk. Would it be possible to have that comparison at the same time that Community Choice comes back to us, or is that too close of a timeline?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Sneddon, I see that there's an intersection, or at least a nexus between the two. You know, you have charged us to go off and look at some of the big drivers of our study. It's not an absolute apples to apples comparison, but it would certainly inform our evaluation of the Clean Power Alliance. So things like renewable energy costs and financing structures and risk mitigation reserves and things like that. You know, I think we probably both have the same risk profile looking at the choices that the Clean Power Alliance has made to mitigate those risks would be something that staff would look into. So it would certainly be helpful. I don't think we'd have to necessarily go off and commission another study, but having that April 30th PEA study I think would be valuable and could probably run in parallel.
Okay. We're going to open public comment, I promise. Come on up, Mr. Gallegos. You'll be followed by Michael Chiacos and then Alina Simon. Go ahead.
Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of the council. I'm going to go off way the deep end here. And just through the fact a couple of weeks ago, somebody told me that I'm very nostalgic. And that's true. I am very nostalgic. And I'm going to go back to the 60s when I was growing up as a kid. Milpas Street, we had about 10 to 15 gas stations. And I loved muscle cars. I used to watch every so often drag racing, burning up fuel and all that stuff. And when I used to go to the gas stations to get my air and my tires and the STP stickers and all the other racing decals, I love that smell of 100% leaded fuel. Just love that smell. You know, I guess I am very nostalgic when it comes to that sort of thing. And drag racing on Cabrillo Boulevard on the weekends, when, you know, Upper State Street, where Old Sambo's used to be, around Hitchcock and Hollister Avenue, War Drive. All that being said, I'm all for this Clean Power Alliance. I am. And I hope you will all, you know, vote on this. We do need it. I mean, we have, you know, solar energy, windmills, solar panels, the whole shebang. As Bob Dylan said, the times, they are a-changing. And we need good change. Thank you for your time.
Thanks. Mr. Chiacos, you'll be followed by Alina Simon and then Art Ludwig.
Good afternoon. My name is Michael Chiacos, representing Community Environmental Council. And we're very interested in the Clean Power Alliance option. At the same time, as we've all heard, Pacific Energy Advisors, who are widely considered the top consultant, are taking another assessment of our local CCE. And we're expected to get that back at the end of this month, or next month. And as you're likely aware, CEC also has significant skin in the game. We put in $50,000 towards that initial study, and some of it is helping to fund this additional PA study, and we request that the city also help to fund that. So while we're interested in hearing more about Clean Power Alliance, we really think it's important to look at both of these options together. We need to see the results of the PEA study before making any decisions. It's going to be out at the end of next month. Let's just wait a little bit. Joining the existing LA effort has some benefits, but it's still going to be a very huge program, almost as large as Southern California Edison. And a local program still offers that great opportunity for local control, local programs, local renewable energy build out, and local jobs. Additionally, as we heard, because of that new CPUC resolution, the earliest that we could start under either scenario is likely January 2020. And so we really think that we should wait for this PEA study to come out. We can start analyzing the CPA option now, but look at them both in tandem. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Simon?
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council. My name is Elena Simon, organizer with Food and Water Watch. So just wanted to thank the Council for passing a resolution for 100% clean energy by 2030 and for very seriously considering all of the options that are before us. We really appreciate that. And we know that there's a way to get to clean energy only using truly renewable sources, so solar, wind, tidal, and geothermal, not including biogas or natural gas. Support the city considering various options like this one, and keeping the public informed and part of the process, and are interested in how we can get to 100% clean energy in the fastest way possible. So thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Ludwig, come on up. You'll be followed by Jerry Brown. Hi, Dr. Brown. Good to see you. Sharon Byrne, Alex Pujo, Anna Marie Gott. Go ahead.
Madam Mayor, council members, I support this study of joining the Clean Power Alliance. The community definitely wants clean power. It would definitely help us meet our 2030 goals. seems like a great opportunity now to join forces with other communities, enjoy economies of scale and no entry fee, ideally. It seems like collaborating with other communities rather than making our own system from scratch could liberate scarce staff time for things we have to do on our own, such as creative water and housing solutions. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Dr. Brown, come on out.
Mayor Murillo, council people, Dr. Jerry Brown, the director of the Safe Energy Project for the World Business Academy. I want to make just 3 points. We fully endorse the recommendation to gather information on this coalition for providing power, independent power through the CCE. We think for all the reasons that Councilman Dominguez has articulated, we have 3 points that we'd like to make. In addition to all of the renewables that have been looked at, there must be a storage component if this is going to be successful, because what do you do when you have excess sun? And then the sun goes away and you have excess wind and the wind goes away. Right now, the CAISO, the California Independent System Operator, has a chart out indicating how many megawatts of renewable energy they are currently curtailing because there's too much coming into the system. And curtailment is a failure. And that only grows and grows and grows. So storage must be a component of any successful analysis. The other points are that we would reflect the concerns that have been expressed that the local needs of Santa Barbara, of Goleta, of Carpinteria get well represented in the governance system of what could be a very large entity. Mm-hmm. And specifically in reference to that, we know, having been before the council sometime before to talk about the vulnerability and the resilience issue of Goleta and Santa Barbara being at the long end of this long transmission line, which could be a fire maybe, something could be some vulnerability here that could bring it down. Edison itself has admitted, and in a very positive way, that through their upgrades of the sub-transmission lines, the 66-kilovolt lines, they can get the 180 megawatts that they need, but they still need another 95 megawatts of renewable power and have put out an RFP for that. That is an urgent need of the community, and we would hope that in the investigation of this process, can this accelerated local need be met? Thank you very much.
Thanks. Ms. Byrne, come on up.
I actually want to speak to you today on behalf of the United Nations Association of Santa Barbara and the Tri-Counties. I was recently in New York City attending the Global Engagement Summit at the United Nations, and the General Assembly President spoke to us and said his number one concern for 2018 is actually water, especially as Cape Town is facing day zero and shutting off water to 4 million people. They've run out, something we can all certainly identify with. At the same time, de Blasio's office from New York City spoke to us and said they had adopted the United Nations 17 Strategic Development Goals. These were to enable the world to help fight poverty, build sustainable communities, and generate prosperity. Goal number 7 is affordable and clean energy, and goal number 11 is sustainable communities and cities. I'd love to encourage you on behalf of the United Nations Association to please consider adopting more initiatives like this one or looking in this direction as to how we can get clean and sustainable power for this community. And because we spared no expense at the United Nations Association, I brought you tchotchkes so that you can see the development goals for yourself. And we have some buttons for you, too, for global leadership coming from local community. Thank you.
Very nice. Thank you. Alex Pujo, you're next, and Anna Marie Gott will be last.
Good afternoon. I'm Alex Pujo. I'm speaking on behalf of Katie Davis, the chair of the Sierra Club, the local Sierra Club. She couldn't be here, so she asked me to read something for you. But you received the letter, which I hope you have read, and we certainly support the motion to consider joining the Clean Power Alliance for all the reasons given by the speakers before me that I don't need to repeat. It may be a way for Santa Barbara to be part of a CCE more quickly, at low cost, with little risk or long-term obligation, and with eventual ability to decide on our own renewable portfolio mix, up and to including 100% clean energy. It may be even be possible that Ventura and Santa Barbara could peel off from or set different policies from the Los Angeles area municipalities down the road. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ms. Gott?
I just wanted to echo Art Lugwood's as well as the Sierra Club's comments. We should be joining a alliance like this. It will take a lot of the burden off of our shoulders in trying to create something from scratch. Also, if you are not going to move forward today with actually deciding that you're going to bring this back at the day that the other report is supposed to come, I would urge you to actually send a letter to the Clean Power Alliance asking them for an extension, not only of the fees, but of the timetables, and then provide them with a date that you will make a decision by. You know, we need to continue to move forward, and the sooner that we do it, the better. Thank you.
All right. The item is back to the council. Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, I actually spent some time on a conference call with the guy that does our portfolio procurement for this area from Edison, and found a lot of very interesting information. And they are, by policy, they're neutral and not negative about any of this stuff. They're a willing partner, and of course they'll be also by mandate being 50% renewables in 2020 as well. But what I did find out from him was this is an incredibly complex and evolving thing. And Mr. Chaco's brought that up. We have a lot of information yet to gather and a lot of stuff to do to act, other than act precipitously. What I'd like to do, Madam Mayor, is I'd like to move that we move this to the appropriate subcommittee in order to preserve staff time, let staff help schedule their time around when they can get the proper information to us, as opposed to trying to hold the hearing up here and maybe be able to move more quickly and more efficiently that way and have that committee bring back to us a recommendation. And the committee would be, I don't know if it's the
Community Choice Energy Committee is...
There we go. That's the committee
myself,
I was thinking about.
Greg Hart, and Eric Friedman, I think, was the new...
Okay, so I would make the motion to move this subject to committee under the direction of Mr. Ford of schedule.
Very good.
I'll second.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Friedman. I'm supportive of that. This is a good idea for us to examine it at the subcommittee level. Would be wonderful. Community choice energy is a huge part of our climate change action plan, our strategies, and we're very supportive of it. So I support the idea of our committee taking it up. Mr. Hart?
Well, I think this, I appreciate Councilmember Dominguez and Councilmember Sneddon bringing this forward. I have the same sense of urgency and want us to get to a yes on providing 100% renewable energy as soon as possible. This is a great option. It's encouraging that Mr. Durrell came to talk to us about this. And I think getting the information from the PEA study and putting that together with this conversation as fast as we possibly can is a great new step forward. I support that.
Thank you. Ms. Sneddon.
Thank you. I'm wondering if it's appropriate to ask staff what would use less of your time, working with a subcommittee or just tailoring what you can find out about CPA to the study that's coming before us.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Stanton, I think either one. I do like getting into the detail with a subcommittee with three of them. You certainly see things, have a different perspective than we do, and certainly add to that conversation, so it would be helpful.
Okay, Mr. Friedman?
Well, first, I just want to thank my colleagues, Councilmember Dominguez and Sneddon, for bringing this forward. This has been Community Choice Energy has been a long time in the making. It still continues to be working on this previously when I was at the county with a lot of the speakers today. And the study that is going on right now, focusing on the South Coast, will address a lot of the issues that came up. The previous study, as was mentioned, was tri-county wide, which presented a lot of issues with both PG&E and Edison. And this will give us valuable information, and I think it will also provide some valuable information for the consortium as well. So I appreciate that, and I'm glad to work at this, assuming my colleagues agree with this, at the subcommittee level and come back with a recommendation. And I support also having staff, while the PEA study is going on, to continue to look at the Los Angeles option as well.
You had something else, Ms. Sneddon?
I did. I'd just like to request that the subcommittee come back with an actual recommendation, not decide at the subcommittee level that it's not worthwhile and not bring it back. So with that added.
Okay, that sounds acceptable. Ms. Gorman, can you read the a quick question from Mr. Dominguez?
Regarding the subcommittee, so is the motion to send it to Community Choice?
The Community Choice Energy.
And what are the types of decisions committee that you want them to, I guess, pre-digest before bringing it back to council?
We're waiting for the report that's coming back at the end of next month, and that'll give us some information too. We need to look more deeply into the Clean Power Alliance. That's what we've been looking at with our own, creating our own CCE, is the cost of the renewables and how we compare to Edison. So it's all of that. I think we would need to look at your numbers, sir.
My question was more, what were the decisions that were going to be made? I understand, you know, what you said in terms of what research needs to be done, only because I've seen us send things out like to Housing Task Force where there was like 8 objectives and a lot of stuff. This just seems like they're going to come back with a few numbers that they could just as easily present to the council and make a decision. I'm not sure what the pre-digestion is warranted by here. So I'm just, that's why I wanted to follow up with my colleague, Mr. Rouse.
Okay. Mr. Rouse, your light is on.
Well, as the maker of the motion, my intention was, in fact, to leave it open because having spoken with Edison, knowing that whatever comes through the wire, the electrons that come through the wire are not determined by any of the JPAs or anybody else, they're determined by the PUC at any given moment, and that 100% renewable at any given time currently is impossible. So because 100% renewable doesn't work when the sun's not and the wind's not blowing, and we don't count in nuke, we don't count in natural gas. There's going to be a hybrid approach. This is an evolutionary process. But clearly, we just put a lot of time and effort into a study that wasn't favorable towards this. So there are other things we're looking at. There's no pre-digested or predetermined answer that I'm looking for. I'm looking for the right answer, and it might be patient, and I don't want a timeline on it, frankly, because the timeline doesn't necessarily produce the right answer. So I want the subcommittee to be able to look at this in as a complete and digested way as possible and bring us back something we can talk about without having to beat it to death in full council out here again.
Very good. Ms. Snedden?
Would it be possible to request that the subcommittee come back with whatever findings by the April 30th so that we can be looking at the community choice findings in conjunction and parallel? I share the same concern that if it goes to subcommittee that we may be past our window when we can take advantage of this opportunity. So if we could have maybe a preliminary deadline that it could come back.
That wouldn't be part of my motion. That you can put that forward to the committee if you like. But once again, an artificial timeline based on somebody else's timeline is not necessarily the generator of the right answer.
So. Yeah, I wouldn't want to be forced with a deadline and then to say no to the alliance. Right? We want to keep the door open to it. So that's where I was coming from, Ms. Snedden.
We had the option, if it doesn't go to subcommittee, we heard from staff that it would be possible to have some comparison in terms of costs or financing structure, risk management mitigations by the April 30th meeting. So I'm wondering if we could have that first and then see if subcommittee is necessary after that. It just is a look comparison at the April 30th meeting, and then from there decide whether to go to subcommittee and what to do further from there.
The motion on the floor is to send it to the subcommittee. Mr. Friedman?
I just want to clarify that the study's supposed to be done on April 28th, so that's the day it's done. Staff would need time to actually look at what the study says. So to put a timeline on that study, and then if it gets delayed a week or two, or we don't know yet. So I agree with Councilmember Rouse, and I'm willing to call the question now.
So, Mr. Kalan, when someone calls the question, we need to vote on calling the question, and it has to be 2/3. Does that mean 5 of the 6 of us? 6 times 6.
Well, let me rescind calling the question. I didn't realize that Councilmember Dominguez had his light on. I'll rescind calling the question. I didn't realize you had your light on, Councilmember Dominguez.
Okay.
My apologies.
Just trying to do the right procedure here. Mr. Dominguez, did you have anything else to add?
Well, if it is going to go to a committee, then, and I'm just thinking out loud here, Would it be possible, and we're looking at 2 months, could we spend the first month looking at Clean Power Alliance, where we do have the information that staff might need to present something to a subcommittee, and then they can gear up for the second meeting with the new study that's going to come out the end of April? I mean, would that be something that would be workable for you, or does that make it more difficult?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Dominguez, what I envision the first step being with Clean Power Alliance is, I haven't seen their pro forma. I've seen a, you know, a 20-page summary of, you know, you saw our study. So understanding their assumptions, understanding the sensitivities that were run, understanding, you know, all of those factors is the first step. And so I'm glad Mr. Giroux is here. There's, you know, he has expressed some concerns about the proprietary nature of that information. So there might be a non-disclosure document we may need to sign. I might ask him what the process would be for us to really dig into the Clean Power Alliance's pro forma. And once we understand that, then when we get the PEA study and being able to understand what the real world market pricing is, then we can overlay that and really understand, okay, would Clean Power Alliance beat Edison in the long term? Yes. Could Santa Barbara County or some configuration thereof beat Edison in the long term? Probably. You know, if one says yes, then the other probably says the same thing, I'm imagining. But that's kind of the strategy I would see.
So we'll ask the Clean Power Alliance for their pro forma and their numbers, and then we'll have a conversation with them at the subcommittee level. I think we can say that. Mr. Hart?
Yeah, I guess since Mr. Giroux is here, it'd be great to know right now if it's possible, if there's an issue with the non-disclosure agreement that would present a challenge to the path that Mr. Ford just described.
Mr. Giroux?
I think the answer to that is I don't know. We'll have to talk to the consultant that has it and see how much they're willing to share. I'll say out of the probably 50-plus cities that have looked at this and the 30-some that have signed on, none have asked for that, so we've never had that question before, so congratulations for that. I will say that we are going to be adopting rates in April, so pro formas are nice because they tell you what might be. Rates are rates. This is what we're actually charging customers, so that'll be more indicative, I think, of where we are.
You're saying no one has ever asked you for the information before?
They've asked for the business plan and the feasibility study, and they've dug into it. We've had third-party reviews of that, but no one's ever actually gone in to look at the assumptions and the formulas within the spreadsheets themselves.
Okay. Well, maybe that's because we've been working on making our own CCE locally. So, okay. Thank you. I think we're ready to take a vote. Go ahead, Mr. Dominguez.
Can I ask my colleague, Mr. Hart, who mentioned something about being expeditious, but you didn't mean trying to do this before the end of March, did you? Okay, just wanted to make sure before I made a vain attempt. Thank you.
Okay. Would you read back the motion, please?
Motion by Councilmember Hart, seconded by Councilmember Friedman, to move the subject to the Community Choice Energy Subcommittee, requesting that the subcommittee return with a recommendation to council.
Mr. Kalan is shaking his head.
I have a question. I heard Councilmember Rouse and Councilmember Friedman make the motion. Then I heard Councilmember Friedman withdraw his effort to call a question. So I think the motion on the floor is from Councilmember Rouse, no?
That's correct.
Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Very good. Will you take a roll call, please?
Councilmember Friedman?
Yes.
Councilmember Dominguez?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Rouse?
Aye.
Councilmember Hart? Councilmember Sneddon?
Yes.
And Mayor Maria?
Aye. Okay. That was unanimous. Very nice. Very good. Thank you. And we'll thank you, sir, for coming up. And we have a related item next. Would you read that for us, Madam Clerk?
Item 13, reimbursement to County of Santa Barbara for professional services to complete the evaluation of Community Choice Energy.
Thank you. Mr. Four and Ms. Parenteau are here on this item. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This is the item that was previously on the consent agenda last week that was deferred by your council to today. I do not have a presentation. It's essentially the reimbursement of the county for the city's share of the follow-up due diligence evaluation conducted by Pacific Energy Advisors to really look at some of the drivers of infeasibility from our initial study, most notably the renewable power costs, financing structure, debt assumptions, reserve contributions, and what we hope to get back is a revised pro forma, really looking at a 10-year horizon and with some recommendations on whether we should proceed.
Okay. I'll ask a quick question. And maybe it's to Ms. Parenteau. Dr. Brown had mentioned an RFP. That's something that Edison is calling for. They want, can you describe that for the council, please?
Yes, Edison is releasing or has released an RFP to try and gain some local resources to manage their local capacity requirements, so basically grid reliability. And at the same time, they're trying to address grid resiliency locally, so encouraging some local generation of power. That opened last Wednesday, and proposals are due to them in June.
Okay. And that's something that the coalition that we've been working with, they were discussing it, and a lot of excitement about that, right? Councilmember Friedman? Okay, very good. Well, we need a motion to move forward this item. Go ahead, Ms. Snedden.
I'll move to support this item.
Second. Okay, and a second by Mr. Hart. Any discussion, Mr. Dominguez?
I think I would continue this until we had a look at the Clean Power Alliance. We obviously didn't vote to do that in segments today, although I guess it isn't necessarily ruled out that this could come first. But to me, it's just, it's not using our funds wisely. We already spent nearly $250,000 and it came back infeasible. And what's changed since we made this initial vote was a very viable option, the Clean Power Alliance. So I'm gonna vote no on this.
Okay, very good. We have a motion and a second, and take a roll call, please.
Councilmember Frieden?
Yes.
Councilmember Dominguez?
No.
Mayor Pro Tem Rouse?
Aye.
Councilmember Hart?
Aye.
Councilmember Stedden?
Yes.
And Mayor Maria?
Aye.
Motion carries, Dominguez voting no.
Very good. We have closed session items, but any council member committee assignments, I didn't write down any for myself. Ms. Snedden, go ahead. What have you been up to?
Well, I have a few that we did together, so we can mention those. Let's see, I met with the Bicycle Coalition, had a tour of their facilities and met board members there, attended ribbon cutting for the Sandbox with the Chamber of Commerce. It's always nice to see creative businesses thriving. Community Development right now is working on their final 2018-19 Human Services CDBG funding, and they're getting ready to present in March, so we'll see them soon. CCRB, we have closed sessions with litigation, so won't report on that until they're completed. The Ad Hoc Police Station Committee met for the first time, just starting to talk about process. And the Youth Council, such an impressive group of youth. They've been training and getting ready to educate on smoking risk education, working on gun safety strategies for youth. They're now recruiting for new members, so they'll be hearing interviews in May 7th and the 24th, so encourage our youth to apply. And they discussed meeting at various youth centers, including Franklin Center, to try and get more exposure in different communities within our city.
Very good. Mr. Dominguez?
Several of us were at the DRAG program, the Santa Barbara Police Activities League, which DRAG stands for Drag Racing Against Gangs and Graffiti. And Mayor was there and Councilmember Hart. And it was really exciting to see the youth that have been chosen or have chosen to participate in this program.
Yes.
They looked so excited when the car came out with the sirens going and the engine revving. So it should be an exciting opportunity to help keep our youth enrolled and engaged in positive activities in the community.
I'd like to thank Sergeant Beecher for putting that together. Madam Clerk, if you would read the closed session items, please.
Item 14, conference with city attorney, existing litigation, as described in agenda item 14. Item 15, subject conference with city attorney, existing litigation, as described in agenda item 15.
We'll adjourn to closed session. Thank you.